Hi, Nance. I hope you and your listeners will be interested to hear this story, even though it didn't happen to me. It happened to my younger sister, and it was a rather brief sighting. My little sister, back in the 90s, lived at the end of a dead-end country road, out somewhere between the Rattlesnake Lake Wilderness area of the Cascade Mountains and the Green River in southeast King County, Washington. She worked some crazy graveyard shift for a few years. She usually left for work at 3 a.m. and had to go about a mile just to get to the intersection of her dead-end road and the county road, where she would stop at a stop sign before continuing on to the county road towards civilization. Even though there would never be any other vehicles at that hour, she always made it a point to stop at that stop sign. One morning, as she rounded the last curve of the dead-end road and approached that stop sign, her headlights lit up something out of the ordinary on the other side of that county road. The road was lined in that spot with a row of brush about 6 feet high. Behind that row of brush, her headlights illuminated the back of a furry brown head and set of shoulders, sticking up above that 6-foot-tall row of brush. She said she only saw it for a second or two before it dropped down out of sight behind the brush, like it knew it was lit up by the headlights and it needed to hide. She said she felt a rush of excitement and fear, and for the first time she could remember, she drove right through that stop sign. She was excited because she always suspected they were real, but fearful because she realized how alone and isolated she was in that spot at that hour before the days of cell phones. And that thing, compared to the row of brush, had to have been nearly 8 feet tall. She hurried out of the area and on to her work. She felt certain about what it was she saw because she had lived in that location for a few years and had seen every species known to inhabit the area, including a grizzly and a cougar that used to come into her yard stalking her dogs. My sister would not be comfortable writing about this experience, but she is okay with me telling it. Thank you, Nance. I hope you can read it on your channel and that you and your Squatch Watchers enjoy. Squatch on, Lori. Hello. I was just thinking about something that happened when my nephews were still in school. As before, I live in Connellsville, Pennsylvania. I was at my brother's house in town on a Saturday night. My brother and nephews and I like to have a game night on Saturday night. The game we played was usually Dungeons and Dragons, but there are other games that we played. One night, after a game of Dungeons and Dragons, we talked a bit and said good night. My nephews and some friends had asked if they could camp in the yard above my house, so they followed me home. I came in the house and got ready for a shower. My nephews and our friends were setting up their camp. After setting up their camp, they sat around the campfire talking. Our dog, Bear, was with them. While talking, Bear sat up and growled at something just outside of the firelight. When Bear did this, they heard something big running down through the yard. Thinking that I was playing a joke on them, they came in the house to look for me. I was just walking out of the bathroom after taking a shower. They looked scared and asked if I was just outside playing a prank on them. They told about what had happened outside. They said that whatever it was, it sounded like it was bigger than I was. We talked about it, and I told them that it was not me. I had just stepped out of the shower. We didn't know what it was, but my mom said it was a Bigfoot. That didn't stop them from camping in our yard that night. Thank you for listening to my story. You can use my name when you tell my story. Your friend and fan, Ted. I've been thinking about sending this to you. I've had 2 encounters with Bigfoot. I was a horse trainer back in my younger day, and I was driving back from Oregon from the Silver Stakes Horse Show. It was like 4 a.m, and I had a load of horses headed back to California. I was driving along by the ocean out of Eureka. There was one sitting by the side of the road. It was a female, and you can bet your boots you know how I knew it was a female. She was sitting there like she needed help. I just sat there on the highway looking at her, and she was staring straight at me. She got up, and you could see that her foot was hurt, and she stood there with her foot up like she expected me to help her. I wasn't scared. I didn't feel like I was in any harm's way, but I wouldn't get out. I feel kind of bad now that I didn't help. She slowly got up and started walking away, but with a bad limp. That was my first encounter. Second encounter was in Santa Rosa, California, by a lake that's called Spring Lake. I was walking up into the mountains towards another lake, and up in the hills as I was walking the trail alone early one morning to go fishing, there was another one. And this one was big, really big. It made a growl sound at me, and that's all it took. I took off running, and I could hear it on the side running right along with me. I'd stop, and it would stop. Finally, I was winded. I looked up again, and it was just standing there. But it looked like it was smiling. It growled again, and off I went again. This happened 4 or 5 times. I got up to the lake, and I stood there. There's a dam there. I stood on the dam, and it was standing off to my left, probably 100 yards, and I could see it perfectly. It growled again, but luckily at that time there were other fishermen coming up the hill. I seen it take off. It went halfway up a hill, then looked back at me and growled so loud that even the other fishermen heard it. They came to me and said, "What was that?" I said, "I think it was a Bigfoot." Needless to say, I was the laughingstock that day at the lake. That's my story. I hope it gets to you and you like it. Have a great day. Thank you very much for letting me get it off my chest. God bless. Larry C. I used to work in the Bighorn National Forest in Wyoming. Sometimes we would get calls and we would have to go check on different people at different campsites or find them while they were rough camping. This time I had to go check on a young man whose mother was concerned because he hadn't touched base with her since the morning before, and they had agreed to talk every morning at a certain time. Now, most times, the person I would be looking for was just fine, and typically, I wouldn't have had to bother go looking for this person with barely a 24-hour lapse since he had last been spoken to. But I had to go because Mama had told whoever that her son was an epileptic and had other mild medical issues. At least that's what I was told. The real truth came out was that Mama knew somebody who knew somebody who knew somebody that worked at Bighorn or somewhere up the chain. You know what I mean. Because you know what? It really does matter who you know. You know? So anyway, I go out to where he said to be camping, which was Big Goose. And I did locate him and everything was fine. He said he'd go call Mom. It was on my way back from that I had my sighting. I was heading east on Redgrade Road. It was maybe 5 p.m. that day. The sun was coming through the road opening in the west behind me, and it lit up the eastern route in front of me very well. There were no long shadows yet. It was still too early. I had a drink with me in the car, one of those fast food types in a cup with a straw in it. I was trying to pick it up out of the cup holder, but my fingernails ended up pulling off the plastic lid instead, and the cup dropped back down into the holder and splashed my drink all around. Although there was no one on the road but me, I instinctively braked and slowed down while I rooted around in the dash for some napkins and started to try to wipe it all up. I kept looking down between the mess I was trying to clean up and out the windshield. I was creeping down the road at maybe 15 or 20 miles per hour or so at the time. I was on a fairly straight section through there. Visibility was good, let me stress that, and there were no other cars out there. Now I saw movement ahead when I next looked up, maybe 150 to 200 feet away. I was still creeping forward slowly, but my attention was now full ahead instead of on any of the drink mess in the car, because I thought maybe what I saw was an animal that was about to dart across the road. I just kept creeping forward and wondering what it was on the side of the road up there and if it was going to cross the road or what. And it did. An animal sure did come out and cross the road all right. Just one I had never seen before. And I might not have ever seen one before, but I knew right away what it was. No way it was a bear. No way of mistaking what it was. It had to be what it was. I'd had to have been blind, stupid, or both to not know it. What I saw was definitely a Sasquatch. I was maybe 50 or 60 feet from it when I saw it for sure and knew it. I immediately hit my brakes and came to a complete stop. I just sat there with my mouth open, watching it. I was stunned and amazed. It was tall, 8.5 feet, covered in thick brown hair, standing straight up, legs that went one in front of the other when it walked, which was clear to me because I watched it walk all the way across the road. And I have the idea that it looked at me when the car came to a stop. And it kept moving across, but it wasn't looking at me by the time I was studying it walking. The main part of its body was longer from the waist indent up to the shoulders than it was from the waist down to the road. Its arms swung far up and back while it walked, but the movement was slow. The whole time, this creature didn't slow down. It just kept walking. I had it in view for 3 or 4 seconds solid before it went out of sight. It didn't cross the road any faster than any other animal might have, I don't think, because I see that people say they move super quick, but that one wasn't. It was more moseying and meandering along, like it was out for some Sunday squatch drive for a scenery. I said that I had the idea that it looked at me. And I am pretty sure that it did, because I remember seeing the main body turn my way, and then it turned back as it moved and walked across the road. But I wasn't looking at its face at that time. I was concentrating on just the massive fur and the chest width. The chest was very wide, and the shoulders when it turned were super wide too. I don't know why, but it's like my eyes were willing to look at anywhere, anything, but not up to where the thing's face might be. Maybe it was just the shock of the moment. But I do remember thinking, stupidly enough, that I was real glad I had slowed down and stopped when I did, or I just might have hit me a Sasquatch that day. And I would not have wanted to write that up for the detail notes. It, the body of it, I mean, looked solid. But I can't say that I saw muscles rippling or any of those kinds of details. The hair was just too shaggy. It was matted and dirty, and it looked like a couple leaves and sticks were stuck on its backside, like the thing had just got up from sleeping or sitting on the ground. Otherwise, I really couldn't tell you any definition about the body. It was just a big mass that was moving and walking. There was no real definition. I do remember that as it got almost across the road, I then had a very good view of its butt. Its butt cheeks looked drawn up tight, like they were clenched in, not at all like Patty's big back end, and I do think this was a male. I didn't see its front package, if you catch my drift, but I also didn't see any female bits up top, so I'm going to say this was a male. You know, funny thing that I remember is that I was almost snickering at the sight of those sucked-in butt cheeks. It looked like someone had smacked it on the rear end with a frying pan they were pushed in. But laughing at Bigfoot's butt probably isn't the smartest thing you can do. And luckily, I managed not to do that time. I was more curious than scared. I waited for probably another half minute or so after it got down into the trees on that side, and then I pulled up slowly to where it had just crossed. I kept having the idea that maybe it wasn't traveling alone, and if I pulled up too soon, that maybe another Sasquatch would come from across the road right at me. But nope, I looked left and right. There was nothing. When I looked off, way off between the trees, I thought I could still see it moving way in the distance. And then it was gone. No more movement. Nothing moved out there. That was the end of that. And when there wasn't anything moving anymore and I was sure it was gone, I got out to see if I could find any prints, because the road there is not a paved road. It's a dirt road. But unfortunately, it's also a heavily compacted dirt road, and there were no prints to be seen. Now, there might have been some off-road in the dip into the trees, but I wasn't leaving the safety of the road or my car too far anyway for nothing. I was by myself right then. I'm a bold woman, but I'm not a stupid one. So, Nance, no scary screams, no bad smells, nothing like that. But I had my eyes opened wide on that one that day. You can bet on that. I'm definitely a knower now. What I'm not, however, is a talker about it. You see, when I worked there, the last thing you would ever want to do was even so much as mention Bigfoot or Sasquatch, unless you were making a joke or poking fun at the entire idea of such a thing existing. You had to be a clear, skeptical, non-believer, actually. No skepticism, non-belief. End of story. Because if you didn't, all of a sudden, you would find that you were suddenly performing shoddy work. First would come the verbal warnings, then the written, and the next thing you know, you were standing in the unemployment line. And I needed that job. And really, I liked that job. So that's it, Nance. That's the day that I almost hit a Bigfoot. And that's the day that I've never told anyone about until now. You see, because I don't care if people believe me or not. I don't give a rat's butt about it. I don't work there anymore. I have nothing to fear. I'm self-employed now. Who am I going to fire? Myself? Anyway, thanks for your time. Appreciate it a lot. Danielle.
Hello, Nance. I hope you don't mind. I have a strange tale to tell you from the UK. I'm sure you're aware that you don't hear Sasquatch reports from the UK, but we do have a long history of folk tales going back centuries. We have the Grey Man in Scotland, the Green Man in the Midlands, and the Boogeyman in Cumbria, the UK Lake District. My fiancé and me were avid adventurers, hiking, wild camping, kayaking, open water swimming, and more. Until, that is, in the early part of 2016, when Sarah, whose name I changed, was diagnosed with cancer. Unfortunately, the outlook was bleak. But Sarah was strong-willed and didn't want to give up our outdoor activities. So in late 2016, we bought a beat-up old Mitsubishi SUV, and I converted it into a camper van. In between hospital visits for doctor's appointments, chemo, etc., we toured England, Scotland, and Wales, finding the most remote areas, just parking up for the night on open moorland, farm tracks, or mountain passes. The more remote, the better. My story begins in early 2017. Sarah and I had heard of a good place to camp near Groove Beck, Highbrow, Cumbria, the Lake District. We're kind of off halfway up the hills there, and it made a great base camp for our walk on a range of hills called the Dodds. Sarah wasn't strong enough to climb all the way up in her condition, but if we could start halfway, she could make it with ease. We'd had a great walk, clearing three summits. Whilst walking, though, we noticed an unusual amount of carcasses of dead Herdwick sheep. Those are the mountain sheep that are indigenous to the Lake District. We returned to the camper around mid-afternoon, as the nights were drawing in. I cooked tea on the barbecue and a nice mixed grill. After tea, we settled down, checked the photos we'd taken, and had an early night. But a restless night it would turn out to be. About 1 a.m., we had both woken up for no particular reason and were just making small talk about the day, when suddenly we were both stunned to silence as we heard heavy thumping of something big walking towards the van. As it reached the van, it stopped, as if it was looking in the back of the van. The curtains were closed, but we could see a massive shadow in the moonlight. We then heard the steps move round to the side of the van and stop. Again, it was as if it was trying to look in. At this point, against my better judgment and Sarah's protests, I plucked up courage and opened the curtain to see what was making the noise. As I did, there was a loud grunt, and the window steamed up like a mirror when you breathe on it. The loud footsteps started again, but faster, as if it was jogging away towards a nearby forest. I quickly moved to the front of the van and looked out the front window to see a large, at least 7.5 to 8 feet tall, figure walking on 2 feet. As it disappeared in the forest, we heard branches breaking, as if it had just smashed its way in, making its own trail. As you can imagine, that was it for sleep that night. Sarah and I sat up all night, cameras in hand, not daring to go outside. We could hear noises coming from the forest, branches breaking, the occasional shouts and grunts. It was a long night, as winter in the UK, well, daylight doesn't appear till around 7 a.m. When Sarah and I gingerly stepped out of the van that morning, we found the leftover food from the barbecue that we had foolishly left out. It was now gone. There was mud brushed up the side of the van where we'd heard the movement during the night, and there was one solitary footprint heading away from the van. We were both in professional jobs, and although Sarah was medically retired at the time, she was still socially connected to work and friends, colleagues, and the like. So she swore me to secrecy for fear that we would be ridiculed. I've told my close friends, who take the mickey at every opportunity, so I can see her point. Sadly, Sarah lost her battle with cancer just before Christmas, so I think she now wouldn't mind me telling our story. I hope that your listeners would like a tale of the UK Bigfoot. I've changed my fiancé's name to Sarah, but I know that you'll see mine in the email, so just change it to Martin or something. I hope to hear from you soon. Thank you. Martin. Hi, Miss Nance. I would like to start by saying that there has been a group or family of Bigfoot living on our 118-acre property in Caledonia, Mississippi for a long time, probably 50 years. My first experience happened when I was young, around 7 or 8, I think, at our old house that burned down in 2010. We lived out in the country with several houses close together on our road. It was those old type of houses that are set 3 to 4 feet off the ground for flooding reasons. Now that place had given me chills on many different occasions. There was a pine forest behind the house that was about 300 acres square. Many times during childhood, we would be playing in that forest and feel as if we were being watched. And sometimes it felt like there was someone standing behind us. But there was never anything visible. We had many strange things happen there over the years, but this time was by far my most terrifying experience at that time. Every night, we would follow our bedtime routine, which was let out the dishwater, clean the kitchen, pick up our toys and clothes and put them up, brush our teeth, and then go to bed. Little did I know that this night would be one of the most terrifying of my life. I climbed into the top bunk of our bunk beds that sat right in front of a window that faced the dark side of our house. Up till this point, the night had gone like many before it, uneventful and routine. I awoke some time later, but still nighttime, and it was after a nightmare, and I felt as if I was being watched. But this time, I could feel that presence around me. That scared me. And I just laid there afraid and awake. I finally got up the nerve to roll over and look out the window, and as I rolled, I saw something in the window. As I rolled further, I saw a large, wide-spaced set of eyes that glowed red in the reflection from the bathroom light shining into the room. They were staring at me. The bathroom light didn't shine in the direction of or anywhere near that window. I screamed. And it screamed back and rattled the windows in my room. I rolled back over, and I started praying. All of a sudden, the feeling of something being there was gone. And when I rolled back over, it was gone. I didn't sleep the rest of that night, and none of us ever went back in those woods. Encounter number 2. I'd like to preface this next encounter by telling you that as a boy, I worked on my papaw's cattle farm during the months I wasn't in school. Every day, just before dusk, he would tell us to pack up and head back to the house. And he would pull the revolver off his hip, and he would shoot around in the air. I asked him why he did this many times, but he never answered me. I didn't make the connection to Bigfoot until sometime later in my adult life. It was May, 4 days after my birthday. My brother and I were out in one of the back fields repairing fences. We were joking around and doing things that young boys do while hammering or attempting to hammer staples into bocock fence posts. Now, if you know anything about a bocock fence post, it's like trying to hammer a nail into a steel plate. So it was making a lot of noise. I was hammering one of the staples, and my brother was talking. I can't remember what about. But then all of a sudden, he stopped. I waited a few seconds, and then I turned to look at him. He had stood up and was now looking out across the field, west of where we were. I asked him, "What's going on?" I was wanting him to finish what he was saying, but he told me to be quiet. Well, me being the young and rebellious child I was, I didn't like that. So I stood up and said, "Don't tell me to shut up." And then I heard what he was looking at, and I turned, and I saw it too. There were heavy footfalls and a large black head moving just below the ridge in the field from north to south. My brother looked at me and said, "Let's go. Let's get back up to the house. We have to get Papaw." And just as he said that, whatever it was must have heard him. The footfalls stopped, and when we looked back in that direction, the creature was standing on top of the ridge, looking at us, baring its teeth. We panicked, and we left everything there and bolted for the house that was several hundred yards away. As we ran, we could hear the footsteps getting closer and closer as it gave chase. I had never seen my older brother, who was overweight at that time. I had never seen him run that fast in my life. The only thought going through my mind was, it's going to catch us before we get to the house, and we had to have somewhere to hide. My brother and I ran, and we jumped into a cow pond that was only a short distance from where we were. And we started swimming towards the other side, hoping it would slow the creature down. But it didn't. When we got to the other side of the pond, we looked up, and there it was, right in front of us. It was making this huffing sound and was trying to grab for my brother. We screamed as loud as we possibly could, and then it stopped, and it stared at us like it was confused. Just then, we heard a gunshot, and the creature buckled over and staggered a little bit backwards, and then moved into the tree line right behind the pond. We looked over, and Papaw was standing there with his rifle shouldered, and he was loading another round into the chamber. And then he fired again, and we heard the creature scream in pain, and then the same heavy footfalls moving away from us. We climbed out of the pond and ran towards the house as Papaw did, right behind us. We didn't tell my grandmother what we saw because she was easily spooked and had already been wanting to move. We never went back into those fields, and neither did my grandfather without some type of firearm. The odd things that happened out there stopped for a while until my grandfather passed away in 2009. And then, well, then things got real scary. But that's a story for another time. Experience number 3. I believe it was early 2010 when all of this happened. My mom and dad and I were sitting on the couch watching television when we heard some ruckus going on outside in the same field as before. Having come to terms with the previous experience, I was now just as brave and sometimes just as stupid as ever. I watched out on the back porch of the house with a set of binoculars, and I started scanning the back field, thinking it was just a bear or some coyotes. Boy, was I wrong. As I was panning from left to right, looking intently for what was making the racket, I noticed a couple of men walking through the back field. So, in true country fashion, I went in and I got the rifle to scare them off. I set the barrel through one of the metal lattice rails that held up the back porch to steady my shot, and I looked through the scope. What I saw was not two men, but two Bigfoot walking and looking for something. Now, I couldn't see anything else out there. I was curious to know what they were looking for. I panned the scope back and forth and saw nothing. Then I went back to them, and there was only one standing there now, and it was looking right at me. It was not the one my grandfather had shot, because the bullet would have left a scar, and this guy had none. All of a sudden, I felt the same panic that I had as a kid, and I started shooting at it. I wasn't aiming for it because I didn't want to kill it. I just wanted to scare it off. It started to run at a pace that I still can't believe today. That field is 300 yards wide, and this thing covered half of it in mere seconds. I relaxed once it was out of view for a few moments, and then I remembered that there were two of them out here. And so I started looking for the second one. Just as I pulled back and opened my other eye to look around, I noticed something odd about the tree that was about 20 feet away from me. It was bigger than before, and it looked odd. It was dusk out, and the visibility right behind the house, due to the brush around, is poor on a good day. But then I heard breathing, and a hand slapped the side of the tree, and I knew I was a goner. But for some reason, one that I still can't figure out to this day, as fast as it was there, well, just as fast, it was gone. It took several months after that for me to go outside any time after 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon. At night, for all those months, I could hear them walking around right behind the house in our backyard. Experience number 4. Now, this is the most recent and still going on as I write as of July 1st, 2020. My grandfather, my dad, and my older brother, all three, have since passed away. And my mom now has Parkinson's and has a hard time moving around. So I'm the man of the house. And I'm the one that keeps up the property. For years, my mom kept telling me that she was hearing something walk around at the back corner of the house at night, and it was slapping the walls. And every night, at about the same time, around 11:30 p.m., when that noise happened, my nephew and niece, who now live with us, my baby sister and her husband, they would all wake up screaming for no real reason. And my niece? Well, she won't sleep in the back of the house. I'd never heard anything, so I shrugged it off as her just being afraid and him not wanting to go to bed. But on the night of May 27th, 2020, I heard what she was talking about. I had been getting this eerie feeling of being watched for a while prior, even though every window in the house, except the ones in my niece and nephew's room, were always covered completely at all times. I've heard how they like to look in windows, and given what I've been through, I took precautions. I was in the shower, singing to myself, and I heard what I thought was someone falling in the front part of the house. Now, understand that this house was built to model like a Cold War bunker by my grandfather. The outside walls are 2 feet thick, built with cinder blocks that are filled with concrete and rebar in one hole and then sand, and rebar in the next, and then a layer of red bricks on the outside all the way around the house. So for something to hit the house hard enough for me to hear it, and for my brother-in-law to hear in the other side of the house, well, this thing had to have hit the house with some imminent force. I got out of the shower, put on my clothes, walked out and down the hallway into the living room where my mom asked me if I'd heard that smacking on the side of the house. I said no, not making the connection in my head that that was smacking on the house. And then my brother-in-law said that he heard it too. So now I was concerned again, but we all brushed that experience off and we went about our night as normal. The next night, my baby sister was out on the front porch smoking, and she heard something walking around the front of the house. So she went around and took a look, thinking that it was probably one of the dogs that we have. What she saw scared her so bad that she ran back in the house and refused to go outside at night for several weeks. What she said she saw when she looked was a giant creature that stood and looked like a man, but was covered in blondish-white hair standing right in front of my niece's window. She said its head was well over the top of the eave of the house, which was 8 feet tall. She said when she saw it, it saw her, and she ran in the house and hid in her room. After that, we covered all the windows in that bedroom with aluminum foil. A few nights later, I was looking for a gaming mouse for my laptop, and I noticed that one of the pieces of foil was coming off the window next to my nephew's bed. So I went over to put it back up, and I noticed that the window was open. This window is about 2 feet tall and 3 feet wide, and is 5 or so feet off the ground, so I don't think my niece or nephew opened it. But I also didn't think too much of it at the time, until I closed the window, and on just a whim, I shined the flashlight I had been using to look for things out that window. And what I saw made chills run down my spine and all the hair on my body stand up. There were a very widely spaced set of eyes reflecting in the light. They moved back and to the left and then to the right. And then they were gone. I got everyone out of that room, and the next day I screwed the window shut. And I reapplied the aluminum foil, only much thicker this time. To this day, there are still slaps on the side of the house every night, and we can hear him breathing outside the living room window late at night, too. I caught the shadow of an arm moving out of the front door window at about 11 p.m. when everyone else was asleep. Just this morning, or rather, I should say, just last night, I set out a game camera to catch whatever it was, but this morning when I got up to go to work, the camera was missing, just gone, like something or someone came, got it, and took it away. Well, Nance, that's not all of my experiences, but it is all that I think are story worthy. I hope you and your listeners enjoy them. I know that I didn't. Thank you, Miles. The following is said to be a true story. I received no additional information other than this story that was sent in. The only other additional information given was that all personal names have been changed, but place names and locations have not. It started out as a typically quiet summer in the Upper Peninsula, warm and dry. This was Sharon and Dave's second home. They called it their cabin in the woods, and they had inherited this modest yet pleasant second home from Dave's parents. His father had been a long-time and well-respected dentist in North Manchester, Indiana. Sharon and Dave spent most of every summer in the cabin. They were both retired college professors and enjoyed getting away from their place in Berrien County, Michigan, for the peace and tranquility of Michigan's beautiful remote Upper Peninsula. They considered themselves youpers, even if the year-round locals did not. Okay, maybe they were part-time youpers. They loved the scenic beauty and the majesty of this place. Lake Superior will do that to you. It was a very warm, yet dry summer, and that had helped to check the infamous Michigan Air Force, the clouds of large and persistent mosquitoes that can torment man and animal. The only other problem seemed to be with the audacious raccoons that had been rummaging through Sharon and Dave's garbage cans almost nightly.
Strangely, their dog Tammy seemed shy of going out to chase the raccoons and squirrels the way she normally would. And in fact, the dog seemed reluctant even to go out at all to do her business, and when she could be coaxed to go out, she would hurriedly scratch at the back door to be let back in. But then Sharon realized Tammy is getting older, and she wondered how much longer she would have her big, beautiful girl. One morning, Dave came in for a second cup of coffee and said, "Sharon, something tore up the garden last night. Everything's gone. The tomatoes, the peppers, everything. It even ate the leaves." While Dave was disgusted, Sharon was not. This time of year, many people have so many tomatoes in the garden, they begin to grow tired of them and will gladly offer them up their surplus of vegetables just to be rid of them. She knew Dave was getting tired of picking up around the trash cans every morning. He had been an economist and liked everything neat and tidy. One weekend, they went back south to see Sharon's mother in La Porte, Indiana, and when they returned, they found that someone had broken into their garage and rummaged around, though nothing seemed to be missing. That seemed odd. The property was fairly isolated, but this wasn't the type of community where this normally happened. And why break into the garage and leave the house alone? There was nothing really valuable in the garage, just the normal gardening tools, odds and ends. The one valuable item in the garage was their motorcycle, and it seemed oddly untouched. Nevertheless, that afternoon, Dave drove into Newberry and went to the sporting goods store and bought 2 boxes of number 4 buckshot for his shotgun. When he returned, Sharon mentioned the purchase. "Oh, honey," she said, "you're not going to shoot anyone, are you?" She could see Dave was angry and that his pride was involved now. "Not if I don't have to," he replied. "But something is going on here, and it's getting bolder. I didn't tell you, but you know on the back side of the garage I had that old canoe hanging up? Well, something, maybe a bear, I guess, tore it down and bottomed out the boat." Sharon could tell he was steamed, but they hadn't been in that canoe in years, so it didn't seem that important, and they didn't talk about it again. And it went on that way for most of the summer, nightly raids on the garbage cans, and Dave getting increasingly frustrated that the ingenious raccoon seemed to be able to figure out and defeat all the attempts that he had to secure them. The dog, unwilling to be outdoors, even nervous on evenings when they sat out on the deck to watch the sunset. And then things got weirder. Some nights as they sat out, Tammy would lie quivering under their lawn chairs, and they would notice an unnatural quiet in the dark woods that bordered their property. No birdsong, no insect buzz. Strange interludes of quiet that had an ominous feel. The decorative fence behind the destroyed garden plot was knocked down. Other nights, they would hear what sounded like someone taking a bat to a tree in the distance. Strange calls, hooting, whoops. They had no idea of what it was. This one morning at breakfast, Sharon and Dave sat across from each other at the cabin's kitchen table, lingering over their coffee and discussing what they were doing that day. Dave said he wanted to run into Newbury to gas up the Explorer before they headed back south for the annual family reunion this weekend in Indiana, and Sharon decided that she would use up the last of the blueberries her brother Bob had brought them last weekend when he had driven up from his place in Michigan City, Indiana. She could make 3 or 4 pies and take a couple down to the get-together coming up that Saturday. Dave loved to fish, and some weekends Bob would come up, and they'd just have a good weekend of fishing, relaxing, drinking beer, and just enjoying their retirement. Dave grabbed his vehicle's keys and headed out. After she cleared away the breakfast dishes, Sharon began rolling out dough for the pie crusts. She knew Dave would take the opportunity while in Newberry to mosey around to a few places and to see his summer buddies, and she had asked him to pick up some vanilla ice cream on his way back for the one blueberry pie that they would eat as tonight's dessert. Soon she had 4 pies in the oven. She tried to get Tammy to go out, and for the 3rd time the dog could not be budged from her lie down on the rug. Sharon began to wish that she'd sent Tammy out with Dave. It was when Sharon had taken the pies out of the oven. She had set them on the small pie safe by the kitchen side window to cool. It was an unseasonably warm day for mid-September in the Upper Peninsula, and she'd opened the kitchen windows to cool the hot kitchen. Sharon had just put some of the mixing bowls back in a low cabinet, and then stood up, and she was just in time to see a huge furred head and shoulder lumber past the open kitchen window. "Oh, my God, what?" Sharon was startled by the sight, and it took her a few seconds to walk over to the other window above the sink and look out. What she saw, she later described as an extremely large hair or fur-covered person striding purposefully through their small side yard, over the gravel drive, and then disappear into the thick woods beyond the shed. She said she described it as a person because she could see that it was female and had large, hanging fur-covered breasts. Not an animal, but not a human either. Definitely walking on two legs. She was certain of that. Her glimpse of its head had been too brief to really say how its features were composed, other than that it was massive in size, covered in brown fur, and that the bullet-shaped head seemed disproportionately small. A tiny, flat ear. Something impossible. She ran herself a glass of cold water from the kitchen sink. Did I really see that? She took a drink. Did I? She was not certain what to do, though in her mind the events of the summer now seemed more understandable. Should she call Dave? The police? What would she say? I mean, would she say, "Honey, I just saw a monster go through our yard"? No, she decided to just sit tight and wait. Maybe she should get Dave's shotgun out. She was pretty sure she remembered how to load the shells into it. Sharon was an extremely patient person, but after a while she knew her husband, and that it might be hours before Dave returned from his errand. She decided to call him. "Dave, I need you to come home right away." She tried to keep the anxiety out of her voice, but Dave could tell from her strained tone that something was up, and he forgot all about the ice cream and drove directly home. Sharon told him about what she had seen, and Dave just looked at her. She repeated her story. Then they both went outdoors and, with the dog and the 12-gauge Mossberg, walked around their small property. There were no obvious signs of an intruder. But exactly what would you look for? Footprints? Hair? Droppings? They searched around but decided not to enter the dark surrounding woodland. "Well, whatever it was," Dave sighed, "it's gone now." They were both relieved. That evening at dusk, they sat out on the back deck and quietly watched the tree lines behind the shed. It was only when it was getting quite dark that Dave saw it, a large tree or stump that slowly moved and bobbed among the other trees. Whatever it was massive, and they both estimated it to be at least 7 feet tall, maybe more, and it was at least 3 feet wide. That was no bear. It was unsettling, and in the end, they did call for the police, but because there was no emergency, no immediate danger, the responding sheriff department's officer didn't arrive until Friday mid-morning. He was skeptical about their report and their description of what had been going on all summer, though he did walk around the area, and he went a short way into the forest. When Sharon mentioned the word Bigfoot, the deputy ignored her. He suggested they had probably seen a bear, and that's how he logged his report. Possible nuisance bear. After that, they spotted the creature many evenings out in the trees. Sometimes it would just stand and watch them, and sometimes it would appear and then melt away into the undergrowth. There was a slope back there that led down to a small creek and then off into the deep woods. It was alarming, and they were frightened. One night, Dave, frustrated and a little angry, took his shotgun and went back to the tree line. He'd loaded the shotgun with the buckshot shells, and he fired a few into the trees and the bush, just to scare it away. and that was it for that year. When winter closed in, they drove back down to their home in Lower Michigan. The next summer, it was much quieter. There were no more raids on the garbage cans, and Dave replanted his small garden. They didn't see the creature at all, and hoped it had been frightened away. But one weekend, Bob came up, and he and Dave decided to hike down to the creek and follow it for a way. Dave had only been back here once before, maybe 10 or 15 years earlier. He and Bob followed the creek back quite a ways into a twisted, dense second-growth forest. Overhead were the large leaf and fir trees. Then there was a second canopy of bush and scrub. Underfoot, the normal leaf litter. It was silent, dark and awesome. The North American forest at its most compelling. Twice the men hiked back into these dense woods, and each time they admitted to an uneasy feeling of being watched, and they noticed how some parts of the forest would grow deathly still and quiet in that unnatural way. Once, Bob thought he had seen something, but they never found a track to follow. It was on their third foray back there that they finally saw it. They had walked through a small clearing and then downslope to the shallow creek. Dave said that they came out of the cover and came upon the creature as it stooped 80 or so feet away by the creek bank. It was a large, humanoid-appearing animal covered in brown fur or hair. Dave said, even at that distance, it appeared in poor condition. It was very lean and emaciated-looking, and its fur was matted, dull, and dirty. And even from that distance, he and Bob could see that a good portion of its lower jaw was missing. It was putting its hand into the stream, then holding it up and letting the water trickle into its mouth. Once or twice, it shook its head from side to side. And Dave knew that he had done this with his shotgun blast the autumn before, and he felt terrible. When the creature saw them, it staggered to its feet and disappeared. The men said there was no way they were going to follow it. That was 4 years ago, and that creature has never been seen there since.
Hey, Nance, this happened earlier this week. So I live in Georgia with my family in a house in the country. The house is on a small hill, and there is a creek and probably 15 to 25 acres of woods behind it. One day, I was shooting some plastic army soldiers with my .22 rifle that I got for Christmas a couple of years back. Everything went quiet, which is strange in the summer here, because there are always birds and cicadas chirping. I felt like I was being watched. That's when I heard a single whistle from the woods. It sounded like a human whistle, so I whistled back. It went back and forth a couple of times, so I went inside and I told my mom to come and listen. But it stopped, and then I called my sister to come and listen too. My dad and my older sister at work, but when they went back inside, it started again. I didn't give it much thought, but when I watched one of your videos, I started thinking that it could have been the big guy himself. Thanks, Anonymous. Hi, Nance. I prefer not to use my real name. Some people can be pretty cruel, so you can call me Jane. My story starts July 4th weekend, 1993 or 1994. We had a big family get-together on Saturday. The next day, my oldest brother and my younger brother and their families were at my home in a rural area south of Little Rock, Arkansas. There is nothing but a couple of neighbors, farmland, woods, and the Arkansas River. While we were all visiting, my oldest son and my big brother's oldest son were outside playing near our barn. They were out there for a few minutes when they came running through the door, really scared. They told us they saw what they thought was a big monkey. They said it had dark hair all over its body, a flat face, and it looked like it didn't have a neck. It was standing next to the barn, just watching them. My brothers went out to look around, but couldn't find anything. They both will still tell you to this day they saw a Bigfoot. Let me fast forward to October of 2015. My husband and I had moved into a house across the field from where my son and his cousin had their encounter. I was in my living room, watching TV, and waiting for the mail to run because I was expecting a package. As I was sitting there, I heard an awful howl. It was a deep, guttural, drawn-out howl that started at a low pitch and ended at a slightly higher pitch. Now, I grew up in the area, and I know what animals are in the area, and I've never heard anything like it before. I said, "What the heck?" And I got up and I looked outside, but I didn't see anything. After the mail ran, I started out to the mailbox, and my husband's Rottweiler had come up on the porch and sat right in front of the door. She didn't want to let me out. Now, this was not typical behavior for her. I also should say that I am disabled, and I use a wheelchair, so she is very protective of me. Anyway, I got Bella to move so I could get out of the door. She would usually go with me to the mailbox, but not that day. We made it to the bottom of the ramp, and she stopped. She started sniffing the air and would not go any further. I went out, and I got my package, and when I got back to the porch, she was in front of the door again and only moved to let me inside. That's where she stayed the rest of the afternoon. When my husband came home, I told him what had happened that day. After I finished telling him, he said that he didn't want to scare me, but he had heard some strange sounds while he was outside working in the yard. Now, my husband is a hunter and a fisherman, so he knows the sounds of most wildlife around the area. He said he had never heard those sounds before. Now, jumping ahead to February 2018. It was about 10 a.m., and I was working in my living room. I just happened to look out my big picture window to the field across the road. I saw two figures moving in the field. I'm not good with judging distance, but it must have been at least 250 to 300 yards away. I could see them well enough to know that they were moving, but not enough to know what they looked like. I told my husband that evening what I saw, and he gave me his field binoculars to use if I saw it again. A couple days later, I did see it again, but this time it was closer. I saw it well enough that I didn't need the binoculars. To tell you the truth, I was too shocked at what I was seeing to even think about the binoculars. I couldn't see facial features, but I could tell that it was covered in long dark fur and was quite massive. If I had to guess a height, it would have been at least 8 feet. It was probably 150 yards away. I know some people might say I saw a hunter in a ghillie suit, but this land is privately owned and is leased by the state, so there is no hunting allowed. I don't know if any of the few neighbors down there have seen or heard anything or not. Everyone pretty much keeps to themselves there. Well, Nance, that's my story. I know most people think Bigfoot is just the stuff of nightmares, but as for me and my family, we believe. After all, if God could create this whole world and everything in it with just a word, then anything is possible. Even Bigfoot. Thanks for listening, Jane. Dear Nance, I love your channel. I find it refreshing to hear that I am not alone in Sasquatch experiences. I have had many experiences, but only one visual sighting, though. As a teenager, my family and I went camping in British Columbia, Canada, in the mountains every year. As I was older than my second cousins, but younger than my siblings and cousins, I was the babysitter for the young ones. I often took them for walks in the woods to collect pine cones or play hide-and-seek. Occasionally, when playing hide-and-seek, I would hear a wood knock. I always assumed that it was one of the kids messing with me, because when I would head in that direction, It always seemed like I heard something moving away from me. I would then yell that we were all going back to camp if they were going to play that way. And then with much complaining, we would head back. The second encounter was when my husband and I were camping in the same area. We had bedded down for the night. I was reading when I heard someone at our woodpile. It, unfortunately, was not uncommon for people to sneak into others' campsites and steal a few pieces of wood. Knowing this, I yelled a few choice words and told them to get lost and leave the wood alone. I hear some being dropped, and then I hear heavy footsteps walking toward the road past our tent and car. There was a short pause, and then they continued. We went to sleep and thought nothing more of it. At around 3 a.m., I woke my husband up as I was sure I heard something around the back of our tent. It gave a few huffs. At first, we thought it was a bear, but then it sounded like fingernails running along the netting over our tent. We both sat, looking at each other, the hair on the back of my neck standing on end. Eventually, whatever it was, left. But we couldn't get back to sleep after that. We got up and built a big fire. We sat there by the fire until dawn. We both were sure there was something just beyond the circle of firelight. After sunrise, we decided to pack up and leave. As I was walking past our car, I noticed a giant handprint on one of our car windows. When my husband put his hand in the center of it, his hand looked like a child's in comparison. We packed faster, and we left as soon as possible. My third encounter was also out camping. My husband and I went camping on Vancouver Island near a place called Forbidden Plateau. My husband had gone for a walk while I was setting up to make dinner. I noticed that the forest around me had gone silent. This creeped me out, but I kept doing my thing and trying not to think about it. All of a sudden, I heard what I can only describe as a backwards bird call. It was a weird sort of warbling chirp sound from right behind me. I froze. Then it came again, and this time it was answered from about 100 meters on the other side of the camp. This happened a few more times, getting closer each time, until I was sure I could hear breathing behind me. The area had heavy undergrowth, so thick you couldn't see the road about 20 feet away. I was super scared at this time, and not knowing when my husband was coming back or how far he had gone, I started yelling for him. He came running into camp just a few minutes later. I told him what happened, but he wouldn't believe me. For the rest of the week that we were there, I refused to be alone. My visual sighting was one day when a friend and I had decided to grab a coffee and drive up to an all-out by a provincial park not far from town. We were sitting and talking. I mentioned that the forest across from the all-out looked darker in spots than I remembered it. A tree must have come down or something. I looked away and we continued our conversation. I happened to look back at that spot a minute or two later, and I saw something stand up and walk away on two legs. I thought it might have been a person, but I got out of the car and went to look at the tree that it had been standing beside. The limb on the tree that its head was nearly touching was so tall it was at least 9 feet up in the tree. I was amazed. I don't know if you can use any of these experiences, but it really feels good to get them off my chest. You see, people rarely believe me. Sincerely, Vicky. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello there, everyone. Well, I hope you've got your snackage all lined up. We've got a really good encounter tonight from a hunter out of the state of Ohio. Now, his hunt started off good, but then things got a little hairy, as in big and hairy. All right, everyone. Well, go ahead and get those snackage motors warmed up, because we're going to peel off the starting line here in just a second. But before we do, I just want to remind you, if you've been sassed by a Sasquatch or if you've been escorted out of the forest by the big guy himself, don't keep it to yourself. Send it on in to contact@buckeyebigfoot.com. Tell me all about it. Then I'll get it recorded and I'll share it with everyone. All right, everyone, get that snackage ready because we're getting started right now. Nance, you can call me Broken Arrow. I went to college in eastern Ohio in the late 1980s into the early 1990s. I spent most of my free time back in those college days, which was not much as I was an athlete, and that took up countless hours. I spent that time exploring the state parks in the area. I enjoyed fishing and hunting, and I missed the ability to do those activities at will, like I had done countless times as a kid and into my teens. The local friends I met there knew the woods very well. As you can imagine, in the off-season, we would find every excuse to grab some beer, gather some girls, and head to the lake for some harmless fun. It made the challenges of being a student athlete more tolerable. During these excursions into the parks and lakes, I would always see deer, fox, turkey, and other wildlife. I made mental notes of the locations, and I would try to find a way to hunt those areas when the right season came along. It was a local county protected park that made the biggest impression on me. Just driving into the park was exciting, as the rabbits and deer seemed to be on watch at every turn. They darted back and forth and seemed to have the entire park mapped out as their playground. While walking a very secluded section near the top of the park, I found myself in the middle of the nastiest thorn and briar thicket. And when I say thicket, I mean chest-high, swirling vines covered in barbs, the kind that grab your clothing as if they were trying to eat you. Now, while it wasn't able to eat anything, it sure could make for a miserable day trying to untangle yourself if you were unlucky enough to wind up in there. I know from my hunting background that this was exactly the type of habitat that the big bucks liked to bed in. They felt safe there. They knew predators would not venture into that hellhole lest they have no desire to maintain their skin, their fur, or whatever layer covered their bodies. There were other signs that bucks were in the area as well. Now, this was the spot that I would target the next time deer season came around. Well, for me, deer season would have to wait. I graduated, and I moved down south to begin the rest of my life. Now, fast forward to 1999. I was living in the south and would make a yearly hunting trip back up to Ohio. Mostly, we would hunt in Wintersville and Toronto areas. Always successful there, I had no need to venture outside those spots. One year, I decided to try that thicket area in that protected area. I found out the rules and the regulations of hunting in there. Bow only, no rifles or shotguns allowed. No handguns either, which made me uncomfortable, but so be it. What could possibly be out there that would necessitate the need for my sidearm? A buddy's dad would walk the long way around to the top and slowly walk back down toward where we would be waiting, stalking, in full scent block and camo. No chance of being winded or spotted. I had new arrows and broadheads on my trusted Browning this season. I had practiced about 100 shots from 10 yards out to my max comfort zone of 40 yards. I felt confident that if given an opportunity within that window, I could make a kill shot, and I would enjoy that delicious meat all year long back in the warmth of the bright southern sun. While I was moving into a position that gave me good visibility and cover, I felt an uneasy feeling like I was being watched. More like I was being stalked. I was still, dead still for about 30 minutes. My buddy's dad would be about halfway up the trek by now, so it could not have been him. I saw no other vehicles in the park on the way in. No sign another hunter was in the area, either. I was dug in like an Alabama tick in the thicket. No way someone else could have made their way into this area. Snap! Crack! The sound of breaking branches. Not twigs or vines. Branches. In succession, as if I was breaking dry kindling over my knee to prep for firewood. Then it was quiet again. I sat in silence, training my eyes on the direction the sound came from. Nothing. No movement, and I was lulled back into the sounds of nature as another hour passed by. About now, my buddy's dad should be making his way back down. As he did, he would flush the deer into getting up and moving. And he did just that. One after another, kind of like a whack-a-mole game at the fair, I saw does popping up in the area ahead of me. They were all seeming to move from in front or from my right to my left. After a few minutes of enjoying the show, I saw the buck. He was magnificent. 10 points, proud as can be. He jumped into flight about 50 yards directly ahead of me, took 2 leaps, and stopped dead in his tracks. I raised my bow. My heart was pounding so loudly I thought he could hear it. I had a clear shot. A deep breath. Thwack! I hit him in the left shoulder. Dang it! He pounced at the sound of the bowstring. Not where I wanted to hit at all. But he was hit, so I would do my best to listen to his movement, and eventually I would find him. I had never lost a deer in the tracking process, and I wasn't about to let this beautiful animal go unfound. And to me, it's unethical to leave a wounded animal unfound, or leave a dead animal to waste. I listened for about 10 minutes. He ran for a bit, and the sound of him finally succumbing to his wound was a loud crash in the dry scrub brush about 100 yards away to my left. I began to make my way over to him. As I got closer, my bow at the low ready, no arrow in the nock, I heard another animal crashing through the brush. It was coming from the direction I was just sitting in. I'm thinking I've spooked another deer, so I looked for it to see what it was. It was not a deer. This was on 2 legs, and it moved through the scrub like it was grass at his feet. The tree branches bent and broke as he moved with purpose toward the direction of my downed buck. He was no more than 50 yards from me. I watched this massive beast as he stopped over a brush pile, stood over my buck, pulled the arrow out of the shoulder, and snapped it in half and threw it. He flung the buck over his arm and against his hip like it was just a bag of oranges. He turned and looked directly at me, grunted, and then was gone in 10 steps. I went to the blood pool where the buck had lain to rest. He had died a good death. It wasn't a long one, and for that I am grateful. But I was scared, Nance. This beast was easily 10 feet in height. He was wide like the width of a refrigerator. His eyes were almond shape and black. And he had massive furrows in his forehead. His neck and shoulders were all on, continuous muscle, group thick, and massive. He was dark auburn brown in color, head to toe. I made my way out of the woods and back to the road where I would have about a mile walk to the vehicle. Now that walk seemed like it took 2 minutes. My mind was racing, trying to figure out what exactly had just happened. I had never seen anything like that. I had heard tales of Sasquatch like any other normal person had heard. I did not ever think I would see one. And I don't think I ever want to see one again. He had a look of anger in his eyes, like I was in his yard, uninvited, and I was taking his food supply from him. He glared at me in disgust, like I would glare at someone that I saw shoplifting at the grocery store. My buddy's dad and I met back on the road about 500 yards from the vehicles. He saw the deer running all over the place and asked me if I was able to get a good shot. I lied to him. For the first time in my life, I lied to a man whom I truly respected. I told him that the brush was too thick for me to get a good shot. He saw my boots where the leather was torn to shreds. He saw my camo gear torn up and said it must have been a heck of a walk to get to where I was. But he saw the fear in my eyes and the shame in my posture. He knew I was not being truthful. I never told him what really happened, although I suspect he already knew something went really wrong up there in those woods that day. Nance, 3 years later, I was back in Ohio for another hunting trip. I was sitting, having a bourbon with him. Now, he was 3 drinks deep to my one. After a while of talking about where we would hunt in the coming 3 days, he asked me what really happened up there that day. He said he heard the thwack of the arrow hitting the deer. He said he heard the deer run off in the direction to his right. He had stopped to watch and listen on a stump about 150 yards up from my location. He could hear it all well, but not see it, as it was truly thick in his spot. What he could not see was the more open area beyond the thicket that was to my left, where the deer eventually lay down. He said it sounded like a bull ran through the woods, and then it all stopped. He asked me what I saw and what really happened. I took a long, deep sip of my Basil Hayden's. In fact, I finished it. I told him that I shot at the buck, hit it, and it ran off. I looked for it, found the blood pool, but it was not there. It was gone. He then said something that made me squirm. He said, "A week after you left, I went back to that area. Sure enough, I found your spot. I walked through the brush, and just as you said, I found the old blood pool. I circled around the kill area, and you'll never guess what I found." To which I replied, "What did you find?" He said, "I found an arrow. It was about 50 feet past where the blood pool was, broken in two, the broad head missing. But here it is." Now, how did it get twisted and mangled and then broken in half? I poured 2 more drinks and said, "Well, we will never know, will we?" Nance, that is a question only I know the answer to. And that answer will stay buried in my soul and in the thick, brushy woods of eastern Ohio. I now know why you call your channel Buckeye Bigfoot. Because that big fella is in eastern Ohio. I really want to hear from other folks in that area. Have they had similar encounters? Thank you, Nance, and go Buckeyes. Signed, Broken Arrow. Hi, Nance. I don't know if this is the sort of interaction that you would use on your channel, but to be honest, it is my only chance to get my story out there and not be called a liar or mentally ill. And believe me, that did happen at first when I tried to tell others what happened. So I learned early on to keep it to myself. If I start from the beginning, you may understand better. First, my name is Joyce. Please don't use my surname. I was and am from the UK, and I was born in late 1941. Earlier on that year, my family was living in Liverpool, and during the May Blitz, our house was destroyed in a direct hit during a bombing raid. When they dug through the remains, the only ones to escape with their lives were my mum and my brother David, who was 4 years old. But Dad, a dock worker, and Gran and Granddad were not so lucky. It was while in hospital that my mum found out she was pregnant with me. David was pretty ill for quite a while and was left for the rest of his life with heart and lung problems. All of this I found out partially from David, but mostly from social workers years later. As Mum had no other family, and David was still so poorly, we were evacuated out to Wales, where I was born in December 1941. Now how, where, or when Mum met Frank, I don't know. I never thought to ask when the people who knew were still around. And to be honest, I was not really interested in grown-ups. I had David, and he was all I needed. He was my teacher, carer, friend, protector. He taught me everything I needed to be happy. Anyway, one day when I was 4 or so, David told me that we were going on a big adventure, and soon after, we were on a big ship for a very long time. Oh, I hated it. I was always sick, and David was too unwell to play when I did feel okay, and I was never to be left alone there. Funny the things you do remember, even after all these years. There seemed to be thousands of people, and I was always scared of losing David. I just wanted to go home. After what seemed a lifetime, the ship stopped, and we all got off. I was so happy. I thought we were going home at last. But all that happened was that we started traveling again. Trucks, trains, buses, you named it, we traveled in it. And the weather. Boy, was it hot. Funny, I still remember the weather. And the open space. I never knew there was so much space. But I still don't remember much about Frank or Mum. Soon we stopped in this funny little town, and there was a big horse and a cart waiting for us with a little round woman that I was told was Meemaw. We piled in the cart and set off to a small farm, I suppose you would call it. It was a few miles out of town. There was a funny-looking house made of wood, but most importantly, they had chickens and 2 pigs and 3 cows. Well, 2.5 cows, I suppose you could say, because one was a baby. And they had a horse. I thought I had died and gone to heaven. David and I soon settled in here. Meemaw taught us how to check and collect the eggs, how to walk the cows down from the small field behind the house. She even taught David how to milk a little. We were never to go in with the pigs or even get too close, as they were nasty, Meemaw said. She also said, boy, they were tasty. Now, why would you want to taste one of those loud, stinky, dirty things, I thought. That was until I tasted bacon. Now, this is where my interaction really starts. Back down the side of the large barn was a small field that Meemaw grew veggies in. Not sure what they were, just all different shapes and sizes. I know there were potatoes, carrots, cabbage, but most of the others I had never seen or tasted. But if Meemaw cooked them, they were delicious. And of course, there had to be corn. Just past the field, you could walk through a small patch of trees, and there was a little stream, or creek as Meemaw called it. We were allowed to play in the creek, but not to cross it to the woods on the other side. This was our favorite place to be. So much cooler than the rest of the property, with the shade from the trees, water to play in or drink, and soft grass to lie in and listen to stories that David told. And I don't remember him ever having a book to read from. We were also told to stay away from the dip, as Frank called it. A pool, I supposed it would be, and it was much deeper than the creek. We were not allowed there until he had taught us to swim. Now, David did not have the breath to learn, and I was too afraid of what might be under the water to try. I did try once, and something, probably a fish or a weed or something, touched my foot, and no way was I ever going back in there. I don't remember how long we had been there at Meemaw's, but it was still hot, and David and I had made our way down to the creek, just taking our time, not talking. David found the heat took his breath away, and he was always so tired, so we just held hands and took our time. As we took a turn at the big tree, which led into a small beach type of space in the creek area, we stopped dead in our tracks. There, with its back to us, was a small monkey in the water, while just a few yards away was a large monkey sitting on the bank watching it. I don't remember being afraid, but I looked at David, and he just put his fingers to his lips and signaled to keep quiet. We just stood and watched for maybe 3 or 4 seconds when the big one suddenly turned its head and looked straight at us. We never moved a muscle, and we just stood there. The small one must have sensed something was up, because it suddenly stopped playing and ran back to the big one and into its arms. Neither of them made any noise either. We all stared at one another for maybe a minute, and I do remember a little smile, as the little one was so cute. The big one never took its eyes off David, and after a while put its hand out to him and made a bird-like sound from lips puckered like a kiss. David never hesitated. He smiled and walked forward towards it, and because I still had hold of his hand, I went as well. As he reached Mama, as we got to call her, David just turned and sat beside her. So, of course, so did I. We called the small one Bubba, and David named them, not me. Mama soon let Bubba go, and he looked slowly at us and then made his way back to the creek. David nudged me and told me to go with Bubba as all was okay. Soon, we were splashing away and having loads of fun. David, meanwhile, just sat with Mama. He looked so funny because, even sitting beside her, he only came up to her boobs. Now, it seems funny now, but David had to name them, because without clothes, I didn't know if they were boys or girls. Girls had dresses, and boys had trousers, but these had neither. I have always thought of Bubba as a boy, and I still think of him as, well, him. But really, I suppose that he was a she, as I don't remember him having any bits. Not that I knew boys had bits back then. Oh, you know what I mean. All too soon, it was time to leave for something to eat. I didn't want to. I was having so much fun. But Meemaw was calling and rang the bell, which got Frank in from the fields as well. On our way back home, David said it was probably best not to tell of our new friends, as Frank might want to hunt them for the table. I was horrified. How can you hunt people? Hairy people, but still people. I was never going to tell Frank. Bubba was my friend. Now, this was the start of our friendship with Mama and Bubba. Not that we saw them every day, you understand, but it was once or twice a week while the weather was hot, and the odd occasion even 3 or 4 times a week. We started to ask Meemaw for bits of lunch to take with us, and she would give us bread and cheese with an apple or some plums. We sometimes got cold meat with cold cooked potatoes wrapped in a cloth. Anything we got, we shared with Mama and Bubba. We never needed drinks, as we always had fresh creek water. Bubba and I used to play for hours. We used to build dams and catch tiny little fish that we had collected in large leaves that David bent into small bowls for us. These we took to Mama, and she and Bubba would just pop them in their mouths and eat them raw. She did offer to share with us, but they were disgusting. and she thought it was so funny at the faces that we pulled and the noises that we made. Oh, and yes, they do smile. Mama showed us how to look for and catch crawdads, as Frank called them, when we took a few back to show Meemaw. We thought they were something new. He told us to take a bucket the next time. This we did, and when we brought half a pail full of them home, Meemaw cooked them, and I have never tasted anything better. The other half of the pail, Mama and Bubba ate raw, still at the creek. The noise of the shell cracking and the water running down their chins was not a pretty sight. But as David said, crunching down on a corn cob with butter running down my chin was not a pretty sight either. Thinking about it now, I have no idea how we communicated with Mama and Bubba, but we did. David would sit with Mama for hours and, quote-unquote, talk with her. Sometimes, if David was well enough and it was not too hot, David and Mama would go for a short walk. When I asked him later what they did, he would tell me of the things Mama had shown him and how the different plants and flowers were good or bad, how some plants made you well and some would kill. A couple of times, when David overdid things while we were out, Mama would sit with her arm around him and his head on her boobs as a pillow, and he would sleep while she made these funny noises and stroked his back and chest. He always felt much better after these times and would have much more energy for days. As for Bubba and I, well, I have no idea. I know we squealed, shouted, laughed, and generally went crazy, but somehow we just knew what the other wanted. You know, I have no idea of time passing. We never had clocks or anything like that. We just knew it was time to get up when it was light, or mostly when Meemaw called us. And it was time for bed just after the lamps were lit, or again when Meemaw said it was. Meemaw was great. As long as you did your chores and didn't get into too much trouble, you were free to do as you pleased. Why I have no memory of Mum, really, I don't know. As the real heat of summer started, David and I slept with the windows open. We shared a room at the top of the house. I suppose you would call it more of a loft, which had a window at each end, and the night breezes would blow through and make it a bit more bearable. Meemaw had a room at the back of the house, as she couldn't climb the ladder to the loft anymore, and Frank and Mum shared a room just to the side of the kitchen. To go out the back door, you had to go through their room, so you needed to make sure you used the outhouse right before bed. A couple of times, we were told to stay close to the house, but only for a day or two. When we asked why, we were told, "Because I told you to." David told me it was because of the howls that we sometimes heard in the night, or the banging. David and I said to each other that it was only Mama and her friends, so nothing to be afraid of. And this must have been true, because a couple of times we found small, pretty rocks left on the window edge in the mornings, and there was nothing big enough to reach up there without a ladder. Once or twice a chicken went missing, and when the eggs were low, that was another reason that we had to stay home. But that was not very often, though, and still the creek was our only playground. We had a storm once, and Meemaw said to be careful at the creek, as the water would be wild. Oh, it was, and more than just the rushing water. We went to the creek to see what it looked like, and Mama was there. But she was not alone. Mama saw David and I, and stopped and stared at David. He stopped dead in his tracks and, quote-unquote, listened for a minute. Then he turned to me and said that it was time to leave. There were about four or five big mamas in the dip, and they were fishing some really big fish out of the water with their hands, and they were tossing them up onto the bank. David said it was not our time to be there, so yes, we left. As the summer continued, David sat with Mama, but Bubba and I went hunting. Well, not really, not for live stuff. But we did collect wild strawberries, blackberries, raspberries, and some I think were blueberries, and others I have no idea. If Bubba picked them, so did I. Meemaw was really pleased when we brought these home and was very impressed with David for knowing what they were. Boy, did she make some yummy pies. One time, we were walking in the woods on the wrong side of the creek, and Bubba saw a snake. I did what I was told to do, and stood as still as I could, hardly even breathing, as the thing was huge. Well, to me it was. Bubba stood looking at it, then dove forward and grabbed it. He swung his arm and snapped it, just like a whip. And before I had a chance to scream or breathe, he tore off its head and tossed it into the bush. The head, that is, not the snake. The snake he took back to Mama, and she took a large bite, then offered some to David and I. We said no thank you, and then she shared it with Bubba. David later said that it was a cottonmouth. You know what seems funny about all of this? While I'm writing this, I can remember the sights, the sounds, and the smells of it all. But I can't remember the name of the town, or even the state we were in. If I ever knew, I don't know it now. Even Mum is only a passing shadow. Frank is a bit clearer. I remember when he finished work some days that he would sit in a big tub thing in the yard, and we would pour water all over him, clothes and all. He would laugh and splash us with the water, and we would laugh and then pinch the soap that he was supposed to use. Then he would get out and chase us. Mostly me, as David couldn't really run, but he would stand with arms outstretched and let me hide behind him while Frank looked for me. As that first year was coming to an end, Mama taught us how to hit the trees with big sticks and to gather the nuts that fell, how to make warm coverings and beds out of branches and grasses. We started to see them less and less, and David told me it was because they were getting ready to move on and that they would be leaving soon. I was so upset. I wanted to go with them, but David said it was impossible. We would never survive their way of life. And did I want to eat food that was never cooked, like meat or fish? And even if I did, how would I catch it? I know he was right, but I was so upset. Anyway, he said, they will be back next year. Winter set in, and I was so looking forward to spring and summer that I was wishing my life away. Just before winter really set in, Meemaw said, we were to have a festival called Thanksgiving. Frank went into the woods and got us a big turkey, and it was one of the best meals I had ever eaten. At the start of the meal, Meemaw said that we had to say what we were thankful for. David said family and a warm, loving home. I, on the other hand, said good food, and Mama and Bubba and Meemaw. Meemaw was pleased that I had mentioned her, and Mum thought Mama meant her, and Frank said it was Papa, not Bubba. I was going to put them straight, but David laughed, gripped my hand, and said quickly that it's not fair that I didn't mention him. I got the message. That winter, David and I spent a lot of time in our room, mostly going over all the things we had done and spoke about with Mama and Bubba. David told me that Mama had said that they traveled along certain routes all year round, that they lived in family groups and there were around 7 in their group. Not that they can count, but that is what David got from her gestures. He said that the whoops, the howls, and tree knocks that we sometimes heard were from the hunt and also from other troops passing through. Some of the places they stopped at, the people didn't even know they were there. Some knew and left them to their business. And some people hunted them like game. And that made the males very angry and sometimes dangerous. Mainly, they just wanted to be left alone. David was also pretty sick that winter. He would get fevers, as Meemaw called them, and he'd go really red and sweaty. He also coughed all the time, and he didn't have much energy for anything. She used to make special soups for him, as he never seemed to have the energy to eat a meal. Spring could not come fast enough, as I knew Mama could help. Sadly, spring did not come fast enough for David, as he died just after my birthday, and by March, Mum had both me and her on a boat back to England. I wanted to stay with Meemaw, and also close to David, but nothing made any difference. From then on, my life was a mess. We no sooner got back to England, and Mum started drinking pretty hard. I know now it was because of all that had gone on, but then I was just lost. David was gone. I would never see Mama or Bubba again, and I didn't even have the chance to explain why. I tried to make friends, but they all thought I was weird or crazy because I tried to tell them about Bubba. Mum was killed by a bus about 3 months after we got home, and because there was no other family, I was put into care. I tried to tell them about Meemaw, but I was told that she was not family. I once tried to tell one of the care staff about Mama and Bubba, and then I had to see one of the doctors as I was classed as mentally ill due to stress of losing my brother and my mother so close together. That is when I learned to keep my mouth shut. Well, that's about it, Nance. I kept quiet all these years, never even telling my husband or children years later. I must admit, I did think of Meemaw and Mama and Bubba for years, and often I said I would go back when I got older. But where to? I didn't even know the name of the state, never mind the town or even the surname of Meemaw or Frank. Anyway, life moves on, and things are buried in the past. All except David, that is. He still lives in my heart and dreams every day, and although I miss him, I also know he is free now, free to roam the woods, mountains, rivers, and streams that he always wanted to, and knowing him, he is doing it with Mama and Bubba. I wonder how long they live. Would Bubba even remember me if he was still around? Now I am coming to the end of my life. And don't get me wrong, it's been a good life. But truth be told, I am ready to walk those paths with David once again. Thank you for reading this, Nance. And even if it doesn't make it onto your channel, thank you for giving me the chance to reminisce and to remember one of the happiest times of my life and to not be called crazy or a liar. I'm sorry, Nance. I was just reading through this before I sent it off to you, and I've remembered so much more than I have put in here. But I thought one of the things you might like to know is that although I have heard so many others say that they got a terrible smell, I can honestly say there was no smell at all from Mama or Bubba. As for color, Mama was what I would call chestnut-colored hair, with fairer hair on the front down her chest, while Bubba was darker all over. They both had bare faces, hands and feet. At least the palms and soles were bare. To me, they looked just like people, but with flatter faces. The hair, when you hugged them, was always soft. At least softer than the hair on Frank's chest or face when you hugged him goodnight, or the hair on Meemaw's chin. Anyway, that really is all from me. Once again, thank you so much for giving me the chance to tell my story, to remember David, Mama, and Bubba, and for letting me sleep with a smile in my heart tonight. God bless to you and yours. Stay safe and well. Joyce. Hi, Nance. I just discovered your channel from my recommended list since I've been watching Bigfoot videos recently. I thought it was really neat how you share the stories of your viewers, so I figured I'd go ahead and send mine in. Maybe your viewers would enjoy it. Usually, when I share my story, people laugh and think I'm crazy or that I'm just exaggerating.
But I'm fairly convinced that Bigfoot or Sasquatch or the Grassman does exist. There are two separate instances for my family, about 20 years apart, both from the same location, the densely forested area of southeastern Ohio near Zaleski State Forest. The area is known for Bigfoot sightings. And real quick, folks, yes, it is very well known for Bigfoot activity there. One of the first stories I had on this channel was from a man who at one time was homeless and found himself living in Zaleski State Forest. And the encounter that he had with the Sasquatch there was very intense. So yes, just FYI, they are very much in the Zaleski area. All right, moving on. The first instance was before I was born. My parents were staying in my uncle's small cabin, out in the woods along with my uncle and his wife. It was late at night, and they were all inside, just talking and having a nice time. My mother and my uncle's wife were sitting on the sofa, which faces the door, when something caught their attention. They both looked up at the door at the same time. They both claimed to have seen yellow eyes peering in through the top window of the door. Now, this door has three small windows toward the top, each about a foot and a half wide and 4 inches high, and they're stacked on top of each other. The topmost window is about 6.5 feet from the floor, so a person would have to be 6.5 feet tall, standing on their tiptoes, just to see through this top window. Naturally, both women screamed when they saw it, which prompted the two men to jump to their feet. When they did, whatever it was peering through the window made a dash for it. They heard one thud, a creak from the screen porch door being flung open, two more thuds, then a slam as the screen porch door swung closed, then silence. Now, the front of the cabin had a nearly 30-foot-wide deck with a 10-foot section enclosed like a screen porch. The door for the screen portion is about 5 feet from the front door of the cabin, and the steps off the deck are about another 12 feet from the screen portion door. Now, considering the size and dimensions of the deck, whatever it was cleared about 17 feet in only 3 strides. The first stride between the front door and the screen porch door, 2 strides on the open deck, and presumably a leap off the deck, completely ignoring the steps. This equates to about 5 feet per stride. Show me a human that takes natural strides that large. And I don't know anyone with yellow eyes, or who would intentionally stand on their tiptoes just to look through a top window, when it's more natural to look through one at eye level. And I don't know if they bothered to look for tracks the following morning. None of them ever said that they did, and I don't know that they would have known what to look for anyway. None of them were hunters or experienced outdoor people. The second instance was a personal experience. I was about 12 years old at the time, so about 20 years ago. Same location, my uncle's cabin, which sits on his private property, about 30 acres of densely wooded hills near a creek. I was there with my father, my uncle, not the cabin owner uncle, and my two cousins. We were there for the 4th of July weekend, so we had brought a few firecrackers and bottle rockets and such. We started a bonfire in the clearing near the cabin, sat around it, and started setting off some of the fireworks. It was a pitch-black night. About 10 or so minutes of various fireworks had passed. We let one of the bottle rockets up and into the sky, and it popped. Then another. I thought I heard something along with the pop this time. I asked everyone to be quiet. What was that? We stopped the fireworks and listened. Thinking back, it was quiet, eerily quiet. No crickets or anything. It didn't register at that time because we were listening for something else, but no one heard anything. We let off a few more fireworks. Then it sounded again, this time loud enough that the others heard it, but it still sounded like it was a distance off. "What is that?" I asked again. It was such a foreign sound, like no bird or animal I'd heard before. But it was still a little too far away to really hear with clarity. My dad and uncle just shrugged and said, "Probably a deer or someone down the road having a party." They continued setting off fireworks for another couple minutes. Then we heard it again, loud this time. This thing sounded like it came from the tree line, which was only about 150 feet or so from where we were gathered around the bonfire. This sound was unlike anything I had ever heard before, and I've never heard anything like it since. It sounded like a mix of different apes all ticked off. Think howler monkey mixed with gorilla, and oddly enough, even a slight hint of bobcat. Then imagine that mix of sounds, howling. This thing was obviously angry. My dad and uncle both shot out of their chairs. I'd never seen these two men have genuine fear before, but this was it. We quickly went to the cabin while the unknown creature howled a second time, and my uncle grabbed the rifle that he'd brought with him. From the deck, he shot about 10 rounds toward the tree line where the sound had come from. We waited for a few seconds. The fire made the darkness look even darker. We couldn't see anything. We didn't hear anything either, except the sound of something rattling. Turns out the deck boards were vibrating because my legs were shaking so badly. I have never been more scared in my life. Then, suddenly, there was a rustling in the trees down toward the creek. The creek was about 100 yards from where the sound originated at the tree line. How this thing traveled 100 yards silently in the short amount of time it took us to get from the fire to the cabin is beyond me. What's even scarier is it probably means this thing passed somewhat close behind us as we made our way there. Regardless, right after the rustling occurred, my uncle fired a few more rounds down toward the creek where the rustling was heard. Silence, aside from the vibrating deck boards. We waited several minutes. My dad then took a flashlight and headed down toward the creek. I was scared for his safety, worrying that this angry creature was waiting there and would attack him. Thankfully, he came back only a minute later, having seen nothing. Mind you, this creek isn't a huge creek. It's only about 10 feet wide, which even most people would be able to clear with a running jump. But the fact it was so silent, no crunching branches, no splash of water or thumping steps, just the one rustling of foliage, then silence. I imagine any person running that fast to clear that distance and then to do a long jump over a creek, they would have made some obvious noise. This creature, whatever it was, seemingly just vanished. Now, I can't say for certain that it was a Bigfoot, because no one saw it. We only heard the sounds it made. However, there are a couple of important things to consider. Firstly, I imagine any normal animal would get scared by fireworks and attempt to avoid the area. Whatever this creature was came to investigate, which means it was curious and likely intelligent. And what it saw and or heard angered it. Secondly, I have scoured the internet for information on animals that can be found in Ohio, and I've listened to all kinds of sound clips of those and many other animals, owls, wildcats, deer. What we heard that night was none of those animals. It was truly unlike any living animal that I personally know of. Again, the only way I can describe it is that it sounded like a mix of howler monkey, gorilla, and bobcat growls all layered over each other, and it was a deep, bellowing, guttural howl of something that was clearly angry. I can't even express what a blood-curdling sound it was. It still haunts me. Even as a grown man, every time I recall this story, I still get goosebumps. I have them right now as I write this, and my eyes have been watering a little bit. It was a traumatic experience, for sure. I absolutely believe in the possibility that Bigfoot exists, and if what I personally experienced was a mad Bigfoot, I don't ever want to meet one up close. It probably comes as no surprise, but I've never been back to that cabin. Thank you, Derek. Hello, Nance. This is Midget Queen again. My husband and I listen to you every night after we settle down for the night, at least for the nights that you're on, and we miss you when you're not. As I said to you before, I have many experiences and some stories that I can share with you. I hope you don't get tired of me. This one is a story. She was the sister of a coworker. I'll call her Tina. Back in 1974, I lived and worked in Lakeland, Florida at that time, and I worked for the original or first Red Lobster restaurant. My coworker told me that her sister was coming in to have lunch with us, and she was very excited about something that had happened to them and wanted to share with us. Now, first, for a little background. My friend's brother-in-law was a forest ranger and was stationed in the Hiloche Wildlife Preserve east of Lakeland. That was south off Highway 4. They had a little piece of land that backed up to the forest proper and put a nice double-wide manufactured home there and fenced it in all nice and snug. Her husband, I'll call him Paul, was in a tower most every day for 8 to 10 hours, except when he had to check various issues and then he came home for lunch. This arrangement was sweet, as he could see their home from the tower, and it was walking or bicycle distance from the tower. They had a 4-year-old son who was a very precocious, busy little guy, and often talked about his buddy that he played and talked to all the time. Now, in the interest of this story, all names are changed, and I will refer to their son as Son. Mom and Dad assumed that Son's friend was an imaginary friend. Susie, my friend's sister, came by for lunch. Myself and my friend Tina were off at 1 o'clock, so we all sat in the back corner for a private lunch to just talk and visit. After we ordered, Susie told us of how, for the better part of 6 months, her son talked all the time about his quote-unquote buddy. He could hardly wait to go outside to play, and he would sit at the sliding glass doors just staring outside, sometimes crying that his buddy would miss him when it was raining and he couldn't go outside to play. A couple of weeks before this lunch meeting, Susie said that her son went right out to play after breakfast, and he was on his big wheel right away and was zooming around the backyard, so she went on about her housework. Now, the backyard was assumed by the parents to be completely safe. There was a 6-foot chain-link fence around the backyard with a gate on either side of the house that was securely locked. The forest was about a yard past the fence on the back side and on the north side, and about 50 yards on the south side. They felt they were safe. There were many sources of play items in the fenced yard, a swing set or fort made of wood, and multiple riding toys, balls and a pebble box, as they didn't want a sandbox. Now, when he went out to play, most of the time she kept the glass sliding door open so that she could hear her son. So on this particular day, Susie was busy at that time mopping, and she heard her son laughing and saying, "You can't catch me! You can't catch me!" And he laughed, and it was a laugh that she loved to hear. That meant that he was really happy. And then she thought she heard some other child laughing. So she went to look outside the door, and she stood there in disbelief, asking herself, "Who is that?" There was this little hairy boy, a little bigger than her son. He was peddling another one of the little big wheel trikes, chasing after her son. They were both laughing and having a great time. She suddenly looked around and was suddenly afraid. Where is the mother of this little hairy boy? Suddenly, fright took over, and she opened the door and rushed out to her son. At that moment, the mama of the hairy little boy saw Susie come out of the door, and she too rushed from the shadows of the forest, leaped over the fence with ease, ran to her son, snatched him off the trike, turned around, and looked at Susie as Susie looked at her, with her son in her arms, and they ran. Susie for the house, and the Sasquatch for the fence, and leaped over it and went into the forest. Susie, out of breath and heart pounding, sat on the dining room chair holding her son, who was now yelling and crying about how she scared his friend away. Susie sat there, trying to hold a struggling little boy, and was looking out the glass doors, when suddenly her son broke free, ran to the door, and began calling, "Hey, buddy! Buddy!" Susie got up and closed the glass door, and then told her son that he cannot play with his friend any more, not ever. He ran to his room, crying. Susie then tried to remember just what it was that she saw. A little child Sasquatch, with no hair on his face or hands. He had hands that were firmly able to grip the handles of the trike, and his feet were pedaling like any other human child's. He was laughing and talking, and apparently her son understood him. She also could see a mouthful of white teeth, and the little hairy child could understand her son as well. The hair on him was not terribly long, but it was brown with a reddish tint from the sun. The mama was similar, but a darker brown, and had more hair. But while she had hair on her chest, it was sparse there with no hair on her face, and had a flat nose. She had dark brown eyes and a pinkish tongue with whitish teeth and some yellowing on them. She noted that there were some clicking sounds the mama made and that her child responded to them. She also noted that both her son and the hairy child seemed to call out the same words to each other. Buddy. They called each other Buddy. Susie called her husband and told him what happened. He got out his binoculars and started looking at the back portion of their property that went back into the forest, but he doesn't see anything. He called additional forest rangers and his superiors, and then they started a search. But nothing concrete was found, except for a few faint tracks. After that, Susie and her husband put up an 8-foot wooden privacy fence across their backyard. But she said that her son was despondent over the loss of his buddy, and that since then he had had no interest in playing in the backyard. Susie said that she sometimes felt guilty for ruining his happiness. Thanks for letting me tell my story, Midget Queen. It's been some 26 years since this occurrence, and I visited the site just yesterday. And that's why, after listening to your channel, I decided to send this. It was the first anniversary of my longtime friend's untimely demise. He had been a hard-living, hard-drinking, burly, sometimes tin knocker, sometimes sheetrocker, called Johnny Jizz. Obviously, not his real name, but that's what we called him. We had agreed that whomever succumbed to our destructive lifestyle first would be commemorated ceremoniously with the drinking of a beer, the dumping of a beer, and a piss on their grave on the anniversary of said individual's birth, their posthumous birthday celebration. The very first anniversary of Johnny's life nearly passed unceremoniously before I noticed the clock and remembered our little pact. It was in the summer, and it was mild weather for Colchester, Vermont, on the night of August the 21st, 1994. The moon was bright, perhaps full, or on one side or the other of it. It was a clear night. There was no breeze, and come to think of it, not a sound. The boneyard was silent. I had grown up finding, as a teen, that no one would bother you when you were there among the dead, so to speak. I spent a lot of time amongst the granite memorials that were mostly hewn by the generations of Italian stone workers that had immigrated here to work the fine-grained metamorphic media of their art. I was comfortable there. I even had family there, resting in the peace that was always in this place for me. This night, I needed to hurry to get there before midnight so as not to miss the inaugural memorial ritual for my friend on his birthday. So I grabbed a couple of beers, shoved them in the pockets of my Marlon Brando-style biker jacket, and hiked in my Jim Morrison boots a mile to the cemetery and down to the far back side next to the black silent woods under a bright moon and a clear sky that was spattered with the slapdash of the Milky Way. With a beer in each hand, I alternated between pours on the grave and toast to my lost companion with guzzles for my own grief. I finished, but remembered the full promise and the part that we laughed hardest about when we had made the pact. I had to put away my preconceived notions of decency and take a piss on his grave. I figured that if I had gone before him, he would be doing the same thing on my final real estate. So I unzipped and I opened the valve as I pulled out the last drops of beer from the bottle and then let it drop. Oh, and littering the grave with beer bottles, that was part of it. It was a testament to others that the spirit still moves us. Pun intended. But it was just then, just when I was in midstream and a bit vulnerable, that I let the bottle drop and was shocked and physically rocked by a screaming roar that was at once shrill and deep. It shook my guts. It sent a terror into my being that I hope never to feel again. It was a mere 20 or 30 feet to the black edge of the forest and beyond, but it was right there. I couldn't see it, but I knew how too very close it was. At the time, I was not thinking Bigfoot. I didn't know what to think. I had read some folklore in the past that spoke of banshees and ghosts and spirits and demons and things of that kind. And it was that kind of thing that I thought I had encountered, and I literally waited the next few days for my ultimate demise. But now, as I approach 55, and after all these years, I realize what I heard didn't sound like any animals I knew of. Nor did it come about that the banshee got me. Oh, no. No, I recognized it later in life, while listening to the supposed recordings of Bigfoot. Feel free to use my name, or you can just call me Rerun. That's what they called me way back then, when death had no dominion, and we never contemplated our own mortality. My name is Tom. The following is a recollection of a trip that I went on with my family in 1960. We were five people in an old Hudson automobile traveling down the road in pre-air conditioning times. There were my parents, myself, age 9, my brother, age 7, and my sister, age 5. We traveled more than 4 hours from northern Illinois to visit my dad's brother near Ramsey, a small town in southern Illinois. My uncle was a tenant farmer. He lived in a very old farmhouse along with his wife and 4 kids. He had an older son in his late teens who helped work the farm, and 3 daughters, aged 9 to 15. Real brats, the daughters were. Not that I had anything against girls, just that trio. At this point, allow me to tell you up front that I never personally saw or heard a Bigfoot. However, I may have been an indirect victim of one. That possibility will shortly come to light. This was my dad's vacation time, and despite the 3 Stooges, a.k.a. my cousins, and their incessant teasing, I was going to make the most of things. I loved my aunt and uncle, and they gave free rein to myself and my brother. We could go wherever we wanted on the farm. And we did just that. I was about to experience a few firsts during our stay at the farm. I found out quickly that it wasn't going to be all fun and games. Our trip there was timed to the ripening of their strawberries. We would get a share to take home for helping in the harvest. So first came the picking, then came the stem removal, then washing, and then packing into plastic containers for freezing. What sounded like fun at first wasn't. I think I even suggested that we learn to like the strawberries, stem and all. Later on, I got my very first taste of milk fresh from the cow. All I can say about that is that I highly don't recommend it. Make mine homogenized, please. Then came my first hand at churning butter. The cream was poured into a huge glass jar with a hand crank. I remember repeatedly asking, "Is it butter yet?" I'm here to tell you, that stuff was well worth the effort. It was great, especially on my aunt's fresh-made bread. The farm itself was situated on several acres, so many that you could not see a neighbor anywhere, even from the barn loft. There was a mostly dry creek bed with a bridge that cut through the property on the north. Beyond that was a huge tractor shed, and beyond that, about 100 feet or so, was a large woods. Everything else to the south, east, and west was either cornfields or cow pasture. If you recall the farm in the Wizard of Oz movie, it looked like that. Just add a second story to the house and a huge woods 100 yards away. The woods must have gone quite a ways back, because my oldest cousin hunted in it for hours. He brought home a squirrel, and later on I got my chance to try baked squirrel. It was stringy, and I don't recall it tasting like chicken. I would say it probably tasted more like squirrel. Oh, and get this. My cousin also did something that stuck in my head. He was eating a bologna sandwich for lunch and decided to give his hunting hound a bite. And then he went right on back to eating it right where the dog had just chomped on it. I think it's good to bond with a dog, but I don't know. That just seemed a tad too chummy. Just saying. Okay, back to my story. I should add also that things on the farm were very rustic. They had electricity and some indoor plumbing, but there was an outhouse, which was what we had back home, so no big deal. Now, with all the chores out of the way, it was time to explore. My brother and I went and checked out the woods. Okay, it's lots of trees. Check off that box. Then came the barn. We played in the hay bales until it got too hot, climbed on the windmill a while. Then we headed to the cow pasture. It was there that we made our weirdest discovery. There was an old two-wheeled flatbed trailer along with a bunch of rusting farm equipment and trucks. We messed around on the trucks and then turned our attention to the flatbed trailer. It was set at an angle, so it sloped to the ground. I assume they did it that way to shed water off of it. The higher end had a rusty steel drum propping it up. We stepped on the trailer and walked uphill to where the steel drum was. We were met with a strong stench of rotting animal. I could see something in the steel drum, and I finally figured out it was the rear end of a pig. It was floating in the rainwater that had collected in it. Obviously, the poor thing had climbed the trailer and attempted to get a drink, and it no doubt fell in. I wasn't traumatized from the sight, but it's something a person never forgets. Anyway, it pretty much ended our fun. We went back to the house and reported what we had found. I was thanked and told that it would be taken care of. I noticed that there was some confusion expressed about it, like, how did it get out? There were no other pigs running loose. Pole vaulted, maybe? And none of that concerned me. I didn't care how or when it got out. I mean, this could be a case for CSI Hooterville. Now for the Bigfoot part. I can't say how long after the pig incident, hours or days maybe, my aunt corralled my cousins to inform them to, quote-unquote, stay away from the tractor shed. When asked why, she said one of the hands saw a wild man walking around over there. Now let me tell you, my aunt was a no-nonsense person, and the serious looks on her daughter's faces told me she wasn't kidding. My thinking was it was probably some tramp passing by on his way to who knows where. Back home, we lived near railroad tracks, and occasionally you'd see transients looking for hop freights. But we never called them a wild man. So why did they call him a wild man? Why would anyone walk out here so far from town and, as best as I can recall, there were no main roads running past the farm? Oh well, we have a pole-vaulting upside-down pig in a barrel, so why not a wild man? It was decades later when I watched some Sasquatch documentary wherein they referred to Bigfoot as a wild man, and I immediately thought back to that time and what my aunt said to the girls. Now, after my aunt's announcement, my cousins, being the total jerks that they were, couldn't let that one go. They started in, telling us that the wild man's name was Zeke, and that he likes to jump out at you when you use the outhouse. I just rolled my eyes and moved on, but they kept it up off and on all day. I have to admit that when I did go to use the outhouse, I opened the door very slowly. Okay, nightfall came. It was bedtime. My brother and I slept on the floor next to my parents' bed. My young sister slept in another bedroom with the unholy three. We were all nestled in. I was lying on my side next to my brother on a blanket on the floor, head on pillow, nodding off slowly. When, suddenly, I felt a warm sensation on my back. The warm sensation immediately turned into a wet sensation. My brother, who never ever wet the bed before, was doing just that. I screamed and jumped up. After much weeping and gnashing of teeth and some fancy cleanup, things got back to normal. They asked my brother about the accident, and all he could manage was that he was scared of Zeke. He avoided the outhouse all evening, thinking that he'd make it to the next morning okay. Then I saw a great opportunity here, and I spilled the beans on my cousins. I told the adults how they terrorized us all day about Zeke, how they said that he hides in the toilet and jumps out at you. Yep. What goes around comes around. They're going to get it. They're going to get yelled at, and I'm going to love it, Yes, there really is a God, and justice will prevail. But then everything went haywire. They didn't get yelled at. What? This is not fair. Are you blind? Can't you see what's going on here? Yell at them. Demons, that's what they were. They just stood there like angels, smiling and shaking their heads as if to say, what is he talking about? After a while, I gave up and just stared into space. I remember sighing a lot and trying to assess the situation. Think about it. I just got peed on, laughed at, and ignored in the space of about 10 minutes. All this because of some wild man that was loitering around a tractor shed. And what kind of name is Zeke for a wild man, anyhow? But after all was said and done, I had one thing to be thankful for. I may have been urinated on and humiliated, but at least I wasn't floating upside down in a barrel. Nothing but the best to you and yours, Tom. Dear Nance, I told you I would write to you about my sightings, so here I go. It was in May 1976 and a very nice day. I used to go up to Clear Lake. You go up Highway 12 to the Clear Lake turnoff. At one point along the road, you come to a road that takes off in the start of a corner. At the end of that road, you come to the head of a trail. I believe it's the Wildcat Trailhead. On this day, it was a clear and sunny day. As for the rest of the times that I've been to that place, I've had a bad day, and getting up there clears my mind. At the end of the road was a circle with some parking. A little bridge crosses a little creek. On up the trail was a lean-to with some chairs cut in some logs. That is where I was headed. There was one other car there, so I just walked up to the little bridge that crossed the creek and looked around. Next to the creek, on the same side that I was on, were three trees. Well, most of the time. This time, there was a fourth one, a stump. It looked like a small animal was on top of it. I don't remember a stump being there, but I may not have remembered it. I was looking at that stump when I heard someone come down the trail, so I looked over to see them. Then I quickly looked back at the stump, and it had changed. Now there was a limb sticking out of it and onto the tree next to it, and it had a split about a third of the way up. Trees don't move. So I ran to my car, and I got out of there. I have never been back. I guess I will try to go back sometime, maybe this year. About a month later, I was at one of my best fishing lakes up by Bunning Lake. Lily Lake is on a side road when you go up to the lake. This lake is about half a mile down a trail. On the lake is an island, and that is where I would set camp. I would make 3 or 4 trips out to the lake to get all of my gear there. Then I would load it into my raft and set camp on the island. I spent most of the day setting up. So I only made one cast, hoping for fish dinner. Just after the cast, I heard a howl. One I have never heard before. I believed I was safe. I did have my shotgun with me, and I was on an island. My dad always took a pine limb or a rake with him to camp and would rake around the campsite to see what kind of critters came around the camp. I have always followed that routine. I catch a trout for dinner, started a fire, and cooked my dinner. Then I heard that howl again. I know there are big cats around there, but this was no big cat. I finished dinner, loaded my 12-gauge, and headed to my tent. I got in my sleeping bag and I called it a night. I was not asleep very long when something came out of the water about 20 feet from my tent. I could tell it was big and that it was on 2 legs. It walked around my camp, checking things out. It got into my cooler and took out everything from my backpack as I was shaking under my pillow. Then it walked over to my tent, sounded like a train, and it started to push on it. Okay, that was it for me. I grabbed my shotgun and I blew a hole in the other side of my tent. I didn't want to hit it, but the shot on the other side did the job. I heard it take off and jump, almost all the way to land. I heard it hit the water and quickly scramble on to the land. I was not leaving my tent, no matter how bad it smelled. I hate to say it, but when that thing started hitting my tent, well, I filled up my sleeping bag. After the thing left, I washed myself and rolled up the bag. I sat on it, and I kept looking out the new hole in my tent all the way until daybreak. Then I grabbed my gun and fishing gear and hit the raft. I did look at the tracks and could see where he had come to ground on both sides of a 20-foot strip of water. I didn't take time to see how big the tracks were, but they were big. The next person that went to that island got a bunch of good camping gear. Yes, I just took my gun and fishing gear, left everything else, and got out of there. 20 years later, I took my wife to show her that lake, but we didn't stay. That is my encounter with the big guy. I would try to forget it, but I watched Finding Bigfoot, and Bobo howled, and that is what brought it all back to mind. Thank you, Stephen.
Hi, Nance. I'm a fairly new listener to your channel, and I've quickly become a fan. In the time that I've been listening to you, I have come to realize that the secret that I have carried with me since 1986 needs to be told and set free, rather than remain buried deep in my memories. You see, I have never told a single soul of my experience, and not for fear of being made fun of or ridiculed. No, I've kept it to myself in hopes that someday these creatures will be known and recognized to exist, and not a myth or a topic for a scary slumber night party of young schoolgirls camped out in the backyard, but rather that all those who have witnessed them can finally get the opportunity to say, "I told you so," and the chance to rub it in good. But who would believe me anyway? Yes, there were two other people in those woods with me, but they didn't see it. But I'm getting ahead of myself with that. Now, I married a young man in 1983, and he was the eldest of four brothers. They all loved their grandparents, but my husband was the grandparents' favorite. They lived just beyond a state park up in a holler that was very difficult to drive. Let's just say that you creeped the entire way up the holler, jagging left and right to avoid the deep crevices. Once a month, we would take Grandma to the grocery store, and believe me, it was an event. She purchased every single item she needed for the entire month, and it took all of us to get the groceries, as we each followed Grandma with a grocery cart, and she filled up all of them. Grandpa never left the holler unless he was making his yearly trip to Charleston to take in his ginseng. Grandpa spent probably 18 out of every 24 hours in the woods. Many times, we would roll up the holler and find Grandma on the porch with her bucket of water and a tiny brush cleaning the ginseng. This actually brought them enough money to help supplement their monthly income. Now, I'm unaware of what the pay was on a pound back in 1986, but in 2019, it was $550 to $800 a pound of wild ginseng. Grandpa would come back from Charleston with a nice wad of cash, even then. They were truly wonderful people and lived very meagerly. The only modern commodity they had was electricity. They had no running water to the house, and they would gather all they needed by carrying buckets down to a mountain spring that flowed with the most tasteful natural spring water I've ever had. Grandma used propane gas that was piped into her cook stove, and they heated the entire house with an old wood burner. They lived there rent-free, and no one minded using the outhouse when visiting. And there were visitors all the time.
and my the food. Grandma loved to cook and always had enough on the table that she could feed a small army. The house was mostly crowded with visitors during hunting season in November. There were people in every bedroom, and there were three bedrooms. And there were people in sleeping bags on the floor of every room but the kitchen. It was nothing to wake up early in the morning, needing to make the trek to the outhouse, and having to step over no less than 15 people on the living and dining room floors. Grandpa knew every single inch of the 1,200 acres of property beyond the house. Deep wooded areas that my husband and his brothers had ran their entire childhood. Most summer days were spent swimming or fishing in one of the several ponds located throughout the property. My husband's grandparents had free rein on the 1,200 acres and had never had to pay rent. All that the landowner wanted was for someone to live on the property to keep poaching under control. Family and a few friends were permitted to hunt, but they were respectful to only hunt during a hunting season and respectfully had their kills tagged. I shot and killed my very first deer on that land. And if you've never had venison, you've no idea what you're missing. My brother-in-law was in the army and had spent a couple years in Germany. It was when he had come home for a much-anticipated visit that we all decided to meet up at Grandma and Grandpa's. I had brought my best friend with me with the intention of introducing them, as I thought they would be compatible. Eventually, they later married and divorced. But that's a whole different story in itself. This one is about my encounter with Bigfoot. It was early afternoon, around noon, actually, that my brother-in-law asked if me and my friend would care to take a walk. Now, I knew he would rather have gone with my friend alone in order to have a more private venture with some flirting and the like. But I think he could tell that my friend was not about to go into the woods with a man she had just met. So, off the three of us went. I loved those woods. I never had to be asked twice to venture up the hill and trek on the land that literally filled me with wonder. If you've never taken the time to go off into the woods, then you've no idea of the beauty and solitude of just hiking along and having your thoughts to yourself without the everyday bustle of the city, going to work, and all the noise that comes with city life. We had just been walking round for a couple of hours, listening to the sounds of the forest, when we were all actually quiet and not talking about something or another. Mostly, my brother-in-law had been telling my friend about his time spent in boot camp and then about his time in Germany, and she in turn would tell him all about growing up in Kentucky. Just more or less getting to know one another. But everyone had grown quiet during our hike at this specific moment, and everything had gotten beyond quiet. I mean, very, very quiet. No birds, no chirping of the chipmunks, no squirrels, nothing. My brother-in-law had just stopped walking, and I mean dead stopped, and me and my friend practically toppled over him as we were following so close behind. I was like, what the heck? But he just shushed me, raising one hand and facing us in that stop motion, and then he says, do you hear that? Me and my friend were both shaking our heads from side to side in the no, and said as much. My friend was like, actually, I don't hear a thing. And my brother-in-law said, exactly, that is my point. Nothing, not a zip, not even the normal sounds that you hear hiking through the woods. It literally couldn't have been but a few seconds when we stopped so abruptly, acknowledging the quiet, when we began to hear this knocking sound. My friend squinted in the sun, looking up and round through all the trees, and asked, woodpecker? No, that was no woodpecker. We heard the rustling of branches and then a very loud whoop. It was so loud that all three of us nearly jumped out of our shoes. I was a bit more calm than my friend because I had spent so much more time in the woods. But that scared even me. My friend started shaking uncontrollably and began begging us to please go back. My brother-in-law firmly agreed, but then shrugged his shoulders and then informed me and my friend that he had no idea where we were. What? "What do you mean you've no idea where we are?" I asked. "You've ran these woods your entire childhood." He then reminded me that his childhood was several years ago, and he didn't spend near the time in those woods that his brothers had. Oh, that was just great. Here we are, lost in the woods, hearing sounds we'd never heard before, and no idea what direction to even take. All I could think was, "Are you kidding me?" He then threw it in my face that I had been all through this land when hunting as well, and that I had to grit my teeth when I responded back that I had never come this far in, that I didn't know where we were either. And then my friend had to jump in and tell us both to calm down and get a grip, that losing our patience with one another was not going to help our situation. Yes, the one out of the three of us that was probably the most scared was the one trying to get us to calm down and to not argue. During this episode, we were hearing the knocking, the whoops, and the rustling of trees and branches. My brother-in-law apologized. I apologized. And then we just stood there, unable to surmise what our next step would be, when it suddenly hit me. I had to pee. Now, by this time, we had now been in the woods for over 4 hours and had already drank our bottled water that we'd brought along. We were hot, clammy, sweaty, cranky, scared, and absolutely lost. But I had to pee. Trying my best not to do the pee dance, I told my company that I really had to go, and that I doubted seriously if I could hold it much longer. I asked my friend to accompany me, but she was too afraid to move and was rooted where she stood. Yes, it irritated me. It irked me that she wouldn't accompany me so that I could relieve myself. She was so scared she said she didn't want to separate, and that we should all remain together. Well, I was just as scared, but nature was calling, and there was no way I would be able to hold it until we found our way back to Grandma and Grandpa's, because we didn't even know how much longer we would be lost. So I told them to turn around so their backs would be to me, and that I was going to pee right there. My brother-in-law ripped off a piece of the bottom of his shirt for me to use when finished, and then threw it 2 feet past where I was squatting. I leaned over best as I could to snag it up, and trying to be as careful as I could so as not to get anything on my shoes, and that's when something came over me, this feeling like we were being watched. And I slowly raised my head upward, and I thought my heart was literally going to stop. Keep in mind that I was in a squatted position and leaning forward, so I was low to the ground. And through the trees and the minor brush, I saw a face. I think I screamed. I saw it rise up from its squatted position, and it took off so fast that I was questioning my sanity. Did I just see that? My brother-in-law and friend practically toppled over one another, jumping around to see what I was screaming about. My brother-in-law was yelling, "What? What? What?" And my friend was joining in with her, "What the heck, girl? What?" I had stood back up, and I was trying to get my pants up fast as possible and shaking so bad I was having trouble fastening my pants button. I started crying, and they both looked at me dumbfounded and confused as to why I was hysterical. In all the confusion, however, I don't think they even realized the sound of heavy foot stomps running wildly away from us. But after they had gotten me to calm down what little they could, I asked if they'd seen it. Did they hear it? Did they hear the noise of those heavy footsteps? I was literally hysterical. My brother-in-law put each of his hands on my shoulders and shook me, telling me to get a grip, that there was nothing there. My friend was turning around in circles, looking every which way, and claiming to see nothing as well. But I was adamant that there was something there. I saw it with my own eyes. I was a blubbering fool and still shaking so bad that I couldn't function well enough to tell them what I had just seen. I finally looked at the two of them, and I told them that we had to get out of there right now. I told them it didn't matter which direction we headed in, as long as it was in the opposite direction of where I saw that thing run. Of course, they came back with, "What thing?" Now, here is where I could have told them that I saw a Bigfoot, but being as hysterical as I was, it surprised me that even in my immediate state, I don't know if it was my subconscious taking over or what, but I told them I had just seen a bear, a very big bear, and that we needed to get out of the area immediately in case it returned. But, Nance, it was no bear. I saw the face. Its eyes were dark and at least 6 inches apart. There was no snout, but it had a nose similar to a human, big and flat. Its mouth was wide but thin. His facial skin was leathery and gray and was covered in a reddish-brown hair on its entire body. I refer to it as a he, because I didn't see breasts. When it stood, it had to have been at least 7 feet to 7.5 feet tall, and it ran faster than I'd seen a rabbit move. The chest and arms were huge, maybe 4 feet across, and it had hands, not paws. Your listeners probably think it was wrong of me to lie about what I'd just seen, like I was being unfair in regards to their safety and that they deserved the truth. But how do you tell someone that you've just seen a Bigfoot and be taken seriously? In truth, I knew that if I'd said I'd just seen a Bigfoot, they would have no doubt doubled over in laughter, and in my mind, we did not have a moment to waste, let alone moments of two people doubling over in laughter and giving me a hard time. Let me be clear about one thing. I know these people. I had known my brother-in-law since he was 13 years old, and my friend for over 2 at the time of this occurrence, long enough to know how they would react. And if for 1 second I thought they'd have believed me, I would have been truthful. We had nothing in which to protect ourselves, and I had to say something that I knew would have them moving fast and not laughing. Please don't be harsh in judging me. At that time, I had mere seconds in a hysterical state to say something in which they would take me seriously about, because this was very serious, and I wanted out of there. My brother-in-law walked over to the nearest tree and broke off a good-sized branch. But I knew that branch was of no use to us should that thing return. Heck, I didn't even think the branch would suffice as protection from a bear. But I wasn't going to get into a debate at that time over different protection devices. We took off walking, fast-paced, and I believed that all 3 of us were each praying silently for some familiar sign that would alert us that we were going in the right direction. We were quiet. No one was saying a word, and my ears were taking in every sound, and my head was turning in every direction, constantly surveying and scared that the Bigfoot was following us. But I heard nothing. I mean nothing. The woods were still very quiet. I took some comfort in no longer even hearing any knocking or whooping sounds, not even the rustling of branches or brush. For all I knew, that thing might still be close by, watching us. Soon it was dark, and I was really getting more scared by the minute. As the sun began going down, I was dreading trying to find our way in the dark. We had nothing, no water, no flashlight, nothing. But then again, we were only going out for a walk, remember? We hadn't anticipated getting lost. I never stopped shaking. And from the moment that I saw that thing, I could not stop shaking. If my legs were of wood, they'd have been knocking loudly. I had trouble walking, I was so scared. We were at the top of a very steep hill when my brother-in-law said that he could see lights towards the bottom. Me and my friend walked to the edge of the hillside alongside my brother-in-law and looked down to where he was pointing. We were also very relieved. We didn't care from whose house those lights were coming from. We just knew we were trekking down the steep hill incline because we were all so tired, and I was still very silently next to hysteria again and began crying at the sight of those beautiful lights at the bottom of the hill. Down we went through thick brush, but we didn't care. We wanted to go to those lights, and by that time, we would battle just about anything to get there. Well, almost. I knew there was something out there in the woods that I would never want to battle. But as we were coming through the last of the brush at the bottom, my brother-in-law, who was in the lead, had very excitedly called out that it was Grandma's. Oh, thank God, we made it, we made it back. My husband and father-in-law were standing on the porch as we came through the last of the brush, and I will never forget the look of anger on his face. He was yelling that it was going on 10:30 p.m., and that we had been gone for over 10 hours, and they were all so worried. My husband, father-in-law, and grandpa had made 2 trips into the woods, trying their best to find us. My husband was yelling at his brother in anger over how the heck could he possibly have gotten lost. How, when he had ran those woods just as his brothers had, and there was no excuse for this situation to have happened. My brother-in-law took his brother's rantings with a grain of salt, shrugging his shoulders, and once again, as he told me just hours before in the woods, that he wasn't out there as often as his brothers had been, and that he didn't hunt as his brothers did. After everyone had calmed down somewhat, my husband took me in his arms and held me, and I felt so safe and so relieved to be home. But my husband felt my shaking and asked if I was truly okay. As I was claiming to be okay and my eyes were scanning the room, they locked with Grandpa's eyes when I said that I was just a little shaken due to seeing a very large bear. There was something in Grandpa's eyes when he stared into mine, and he knew that I was not talking about a bear. And I'd swear that he knew exactly what I had seen. Grandpa knew. And I got this overwhelming feeling that he knew exactly what I saw because he knew it was out there. Of course, we were all questioned about the bear, but my brother-in-law and friend said that they didn't see it, that they'd only heard some odd sounds and that there was this awful smell. Soon as he mentioned the smell, my head swung around quickly in his directions, and I asked, "You smelled that, too?" My friend was quick to add, "Yeah, how could we miss that? It was horrible. It was worse than a skunk." My brother-in-law stated that it was so bad that it would gag a maggot off a dead dog. Now, that's pretty rank. We all finally got to bed around 2 a.m., but I couldn't sleep, and I had to use the outhouse so bad. But no way was I going out there alone. But I didn't want to wake anyone to have to go with me. I got up, and I quietly walked through the house to see Grandpa sitting up and working on one of his many pocket watches, his only other hobby besides hunting for ginseng. I stopped, and I stood next to the table waiting for Grandpa to look up in my direction. But he just kept his head down and kept fiddling with his watches. He suddenly spoke and broke the silence. He still didn't look up from his watches, but said simply, "I've seen him off and on for a few years now. I don't bother him, and he doesn't bother me. I call him Rufus, and he's harmless." I had no reply. I was stunned. Harmless? Harmless? But I just stood next to the table and said absolutely nothing. I turned round and went back to bed, telling myself my business can wait until daylight. I knew I wouldn't sleep, but I didn't care. And whether I'd done my business or not, I knew I wasn't going to sleep that night. You know, for years now, I keep going back to that time, to that moment when I was squatted down and I came face to face with Rufus. And I don't know why he ran. Why? Why didn't he growl or shake the trees or something? I've so many questions unanswered, and I've never spoken about it to anyone until now. Thank you, Nance, for taking the time to read my email. This encounter happened in an area known here by the locals as Duck Creek. It's a small, tiny area just past Water Smith State Park in West Virginia. Should you find my story worthy of your listeners, just call me Jan. My encounter with Bigfoot. In 1967, my husband at the time and I were visiting friends in Addy, Washington. My husband was the son of a dairy farmer in Los Angeles, California. I myself had grown up in Spokane, Washington, and was comfortable in the woods, as my parents had taken us to the lakes and into the woods to camp. As this was the first time that I had an opportunity to educate my husband on the benefits of camping out, I wanted to ease him into the concept. The farm that our friends owned were surrounded primarily by dense woods and low visibility. Being newlyweds, we decided to just go up a logging road on the property. So me, with my trusty .22 that was, of course, loaded, and our dog, and some sleeping bags in the back of the pickup, we went to sleep in privacy, and we took a look at how the stars look in a smog-free environment. He, of course, was amazed by the stars in the clear air. We finally got settled in for the night, and so as to not have my city-fied husband to be able to see some security, I pointed out that if he stood up in the bed of the truck, he could see the porch light on our friend's house. I didn't want him to be scared. We were just dozing off when the bushes beside the pickup started shaking. I thought it was our friends trying to initiate my husband into the art of camping. I hollered at them to please don't scare my hubby. The shaking continued and increased in volume. I finally reached down and grabbed the flashlight and pointed it into the bushes, aiming about people high. At this point, the dog's hair is straight up on his back, and I'm getting a little impatient with our friends that were taking it too far. So I hand my flashlight to my husband, grab the .22 with the intent of shooting it in the air with no possibility of hitting one of the participants, just to let them know we were not amused. Now, at that point, several things happened at the same time. My husband was on the verge of tears and preparing to jump out of the back of the pickup and seek the safety that was promised by that porch light. The dog is definitely not willing to let friend or foe get anywhere near me or the pickup. And I was getting a little bit nervous. Then the shaking became violent, and the thing screamed a sound that I had never heard before. I was pretty nimble, so I told my hubby, hang on tight. We were definitely getting out of there, now. I grabbed the window frame of the pickup, and I swung my legs in through the open window and started the pickup, and then hit the reverse, backing out of the logging road as fast as I could go. By the time that we pulled up in front of the back door, at warp speed, I might add, the rest of the house was trying to figure out what was making that hideous, terrible scream. We could hear it in the woods almost all night long, and it was alternating between tearing brush out of the ground and screaming till just after dawn. We went up and explored the area around where we had parked during the heat of the day and en masse, just in case it was waiting for one of us to come up by ourselves and to finish whatever it was up to. We found saplings pulled out by the roots, hanging clear halfway up a pine tree that no person could possibly tear out of the ground, let alone hurl it up 50 feet to lodge it into a 100-foot tree. We found brown coarse hair on the bushes and clumps, and footprints that were of barefoot ape-like feet, except they looked more like a man's, only extremely large for a man's feet. When I was jumping through the window of the pickup, my husband raised the flashlight up to better get a hold of the dog. The light reflected off very large eyes that were huge by comparison to a man's and very far apart. We were convinced it was a Bigfoot. We were very careful, though, who we told that to, as at that time, they were considered to be in the same category as Nessie, the Loch Ness Monster. It was not anything that you would admit to, because people would think you were totally telling a story like snipe hunting or jackalopes. It was years later, after my husband was no longer in the picture, and I was attending a university, and I was in an anthropology class. I was also in on the on-campus Bigfoot Club. I relayed this experience to the club, and from there I heard other stories told. There have been numerous accounts of people's encounters with Bigfoot. I have lived in North Idaho for 40 years and have heard accounts in person, on the media, and through the club. I definitely am a Bigfoot believer, and I also believe that it is not their intent to harm anyone. Well, that is my experience, and whether you believe it or not, I can certainly add some credence to the possibility. Thanks for reading. Just call me Sweet William. Back in 1975, my Boy Scout troop decided to hike to King's Peak in the Uinta Mountains, only mountains running east and west. The entire mountain range is in a primitive area. No motor vehicles or motorcycles allowed. Rangers patrol by horseback. Going to the peak is 52 miles, and most of the mountains are above the tree line. A full week was planned. We took freeze-dried food and propane canisters. Wednesday, we made the peak, and then back to base. That night, we wanted a real fire. Scoutmaster assigned three of us to travel down to the trees to find dry wood to bring back to base camp. My two friends and I left to make the trip. We went along a ridge looking over the bank. We saw a deer grazing in an open area. Then we heard a clicking noise from behind the deer. Then from another side came more clicking, and back and forth like they were communicating. Suddenly, a dark figure reached out, grabbed the deer, and it went down. We thought it was a black bear, because it was eating the underside of the deer with its hands, scooping it into its mouth. It then stood up, picked up the deer with one hand, and ran back into the forest. We were looking down about 50 feet above this. We did not want to go down for wood. We went back to base empty-handed, and everyone asked, why no wood? We told them what we witnessed, so my scoutmaster pulled out a rifle, and the troop all joined to go down to where we saw the attack. Most of the floor was flat rock, and we could see a big blood spot where the deer had died, and then found big human footprints, but not in the soil. The left foot had stepped in the blood, and like 12 feet from one step to the other. Then one of my friends spotted a deer head up in a tree near the top, like it had pulled it off the body and threw it up in the tree. We told the ranger about the attack that had happened, and he followed us to that spot, and they measured the steps and the size, and he said that he would write a report, and he asked us not to talk about it, because it could impact their investigation. Thanks, Brian. Hi, Nance. I'm 56 now, but I remember all this clear. I learned the outdoors from my dad and granddad. Growing up in northern Minnesota, there was a lot of opportunity for that. I was 15 when they took me out on my first deer and elk hunts. We had gone deep north woods to my granddad's little place up there. When all this happened, I didn't know what it all was, but now it all makes sense. That time there were four of us, my dad, my granddad, an uncle, and a cousin of mine. That cousin was about 6 years older than me, so he pretty much was as good and experienced on things where I wasn't. Part of my education, initiation, or whatever you want to call it, was to have to harvest the camp meat. It was a doe, and it wasn't the cleanest hit on her, and she had left a big old trail of blood halfway across the state, it looked like. But it was easy to find her, even when she headed into the piney tree growth. I took my rifle with me, and I found her, and I got to work. I got the front shoulders and the back straps, and I took off and took those back up to the cabin. While dropping the meat up at the cabin, at some point I set my rifle down, and I didn't pick it back up before I headed back out to get the rest of the meat. So I walked back with just a hatchet and a knife on me. But surprise, surprise, I got there, and she was gone. There was no mistaking where she had been. The blood spot was real clear. The debris I had left from cutting was there. I knew I was at the right spot. And I hadn't been gone a total of an hour since I first left the carcass. So what the heck happened to her? Then it hit me. She didn't get up and walk away. That was clear. Something took her away. And that something had to be a big something that ate meat. And then I realized I didn't have my rifle with me. Talk about hair standing up. Mine was right then. I concentrated on looking and listening. Even scared as I was, I knew worst thing I could do was to run blindly if I had a big predator close by, even if he did already have himself a doe for his dinner. My running could trigger his predator instinct, and I could be his dessert. So I was looking and listening, and that's when I saw drag marks through the pine needles and the soft dirt. I also saw unmistakable prints, huge footprints, big human-like footprints. But then as soon as I saw that and I thought that, I knew that wasn't right. First, couldn't no human have feet that big, and ain't no human walking around up there barefoot at that time of year on that kind of terrain. And I knew that all the land around was very privately owned, and there wasn't no way someone could just easily trespass back there. If the hair wasn't already standing up all over on my body before, it was dancing now, because I felt strongly that I was being watched. And then, probably 50 or 60 feet further down in the tree growth, I thought I saw something move between the trees. I looked again, and yes, something was moving back there in the trees, zigzagging back and forth. That was it. I was done. Predator or not out there, I was out of there like lightning. I hightailed it back to our cabin, praying that whatever it wasn't following me. When I got there, and I told my dad and granddad, my uncle and my cousin what happened, well, they all had a different opinion of just what it was that took the carcass, but they all agreed that it was just a predator of some sort. And then I got the gentle chewing out about leaving my rifle and walking out of camp, and I was told to let this be a lesson. Dark was coming on, so none of us went down to go look it over. About 2 nights later, we were all just settling in when we had heard something starting to move around outside. Thinking it was just a bear nosing around out there, we ignored it because there was nothing out there for it to get into, and we felt secure in the cabin. And just when we started to feel that kind of secure, that's when the screeching started, and then we all knew that was no bear. Granddad just told us all to keep our rifles close. But whatever it was, he said, don't worry, because we were safe inside. The screeching didn't last long, but I don't think that I was the only one who didn't sleep much the rest of the night. The next morning, there were lots of signs that something had been walking all around our cabin. They weren't deeply printed down like out under the piney tree growth where my carcass was stolen, but I was pretty sure that what I was seeing were some of the same big human-like prints. The other said that it was just a black bear, a really big one, and that it had walked around so much that all the prints were getting overlaid on top of each other, and that just made them look like great big huge prints. We left that next day as we had already planned. And when we left, Nance, I was of a mind that it really was just a bear, because I really didn't know what else it could be, and I just figured that those older men knew so much more than me, and if that's what they thought it was, then by golly, that's what it was. Except, it still never quite set right with me. I found this out many years later, after I'd gotten a lot more experience out there in the woods under my belt, and when it still didn't set right with me, I found out that I wasn't the only one that felt that way. I finally broke down and I asked Dad about it. Granddad was gone by then, so I couldn't ask him. But Dad never outright said the word Sasquatch. But he did hesitatingly agree that he didn't think What happened there was a bear. And he didn't think that Granddad thought so either. But that was the story they kind of kept together, so everything didn't go haywire at the cabin. So, if I did see a Bigfoot or a Sasquatch, it was from a distance, in heavy tree growth, and it was as darkness was coming on, and it wasn't clear at all. I couldn't even tell you if what I saw back there was brown or black. It was just some dark thing moving out there in the falling darkness under the trees. But yes, to this day, I firmly believe that I saw one at a distance, and I believe that one stole our meat, and that one screeched and howled at us all night as it stomped around our cabin. Well, I appreciate you giving this a read. Thank you, James.